Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Escape from the Dragon Czar, an Aegis of Merlin story by James E. Wisher. Narrated by Jesse Vilinsky. 1. On the Run. Anya fidgeted and smoothed the front of her best white dress. She sat in one of the hard-backed chairs at their little dining room table. A slightly wilted bunch of daisies resting in a blue vase served as both centerpiece and metaphor. Their whole house sagged like the flowers. The roof needed new shingles, moss covered the cedar siding, and the shutters hung askew. Since Dad died 3 years ago, nothing had been fixed. For a man that had so many friends when alive, he certainly had few enough in death. The delightful scent of baked apple wafted out of the kitchen, making her mouth water. Her mother puttered about at the oven, getting everything ready. Anya loved baked apples, and every year on her birthday, Mom broke into their savings to buy the costly spices to fix one for her. Hard slats dug into her back, forcing her to shift again. From the kitchen came a curse, followed by the oven door slamming.
Are you okay, Mom?
Anya got up and took a step toward the kitchen. Her mother appeared in the open door. She smiled, and the fine lines around her eyes crinkled, and gray blonde hair spilled down over her blue eyes.
I'm fine, Kiska. Sit down. This is your special day.
Anya sighed and returned to her uncomfortable chair.
Mom, I'm too old for you to call me kitten.
Her mother brushed a strand of hair out of her eyes.
You'll always be my little Kiska, even when you're as old and gray as me.
She smiled as her mother disappeared into the kitchen to finish the baked apple. Listening to her talk, you'd think Mom was ancient rather than just 40. Anya licked her lips and pictured the apple coming out of the oven. She ran a finger over the battered fork in front of her. Not much longer now. Maybe they could finish before anyone showed up. Normally, this was her favorite day of the year. But this year, they expected a special, if unwelcome, guest. One of the Tsar's white witches would arrive soon to test Anya. If the test revealed wizard potential, she'd be taken to New St. Petersburg to meet the Tsar. She shuddered at the thought of having to leave their little village and never seeing her mother again. All the girls in the Empire of the Dragon Czar got this visit on their 18th birthdays, and they'd all heard the stories as well. Stories of girls taken away and never being heard from again. Anya didn't know how much credit to give the stories. Most of them sounded like nonsense, but people did vanish. And they did it often enough that it had become an almost normal part of life in the Empire. Mom emerged from the kitchen in a swirl of green skirt. She held a steaming red apple dripping with honey. Anya grinned.
Ta-da!
She set the plate in front of Anya and kissed her forehead.
Happy birthday, Kiska.
Thanks, Mom. Anya picked up her fork and knife as her mother rounded the table. She breathed in the scent of cinnamon and nutmeg. Both spices cost more than they spent on food in a week. But today only they splurged. She almost felt guilty. Almost. Anya cut a chunk out of the warm, soft apple, taking her time and savoring the moment. The first bite was halfway to her mouth when someone knocked on the door. Before either of them could get up to answer it, the door opened and a woman in white robes with hair as pale as fresh snow stepped inside like she owned the place. Mom scrambled to her feet and Anya quickly joined her, her special treat forgotten.
Welcome, mistress, Mom said. May I offer you?
The white witch held up a hand and Mom fell silent.
This will not take long.
Her voice was as cold as a midwinter night. From the folds of her robe, the witch withdrew a length of smooth wood inset with 6 clear gems. She strode from the door to their table and held the rod out to Anya, who stared at the smooth, dark length of wood.
"Don't look at it, fool. Take it," the witch said.
Anya grasped the device with a trembling hand and held her breath. She said a silent prayer to any god that might be listening.
"Please, oh please, let nothing happen. Let me fail this test and get on with the rest of my boring life."
As if to mock her, the first gem burst into light. Anya's heart sank. She had magic in her blood. Now her life was over. The second gem lit up, then a third, and fourth. When another half a minute passed and nothing happened, the witch snatched the rod out of her hand.
"Congratulations, sister. You will have the honor of joining our ranks in glorious service to the Tsar. I trust your bag is prepared in accordance with the law."
"Yes, mistress."
Somehow, Anya forced the words past her numb lips.
"Well, don't just stand there, girl. Go get it. I have 20 more stops to make today."
Mind racing and rigid with fear, Anya walked up the stairs to her room on the second floor. She pushed the door open and looked for the last time at the soft gray blanket that covered her narrow bed, the handful of stuffed animals her father had bought her before he died, and last, the ancient carved wardrobe, originally owned by her great-grandmother, who had left it to Anya when she died. All Anya's meager possessions fit in it with room to spare. She'd never see any of them again. Her battered leather valise sat on the floor in front of the bed. She staggered over to it like a clockwork figure from a story and picked it up. Silent tears ran down her face. Anya looked out the single narrow window. She could jump out, but the fall wouldn't kill her. Maybe she'd break a leg, but that wouldn't spare her. If anything, it would simply annoy the witch, and maybe bring down some sort of punishment on her mother.
"Hurry up, girl!"
How Anya would have liked to strangle the witch. Who did she think she was, turning Anya's life upside down like this? She wiped her eyes and turned her back on everything she'd ever known. At the bottom of the steps, the witch stood, toe tapping and hard, pale eyes glaring up at Anya. Beyond her, on the opposite side of the table, her mother wrung her hands and watched as Anya went down the steps.
"Finally! Come along!"
The witch marched toward the door. Anya fell in behind her. Her gaze darted to her mother. She wanted to ask for advice, reassurance, anything to delay the inevitable.
"Be brave, Kiska. Everything will work out."
How could everything work out? She was being dragged away from her home, practically kidnapped by this woman in white. The witch stopped in the doorway and turned back.
"Hurry up, girl. We haven't got—"
A straight, double-edged dagger drove into the witch's throat. Blood shot out, glittering in the air like floating rubies. Anya dropped her bag and brought her hands to her mouth. The witch stared in total disbelief, a hand clamped to her neck in a vain attempt to stop her life from gushing out. At last, she collapsed, revealing a broad, paunchy man with a heavy gray beard behind her, holding a dripping knife. Anya stared first at the dead witch, then at her murderer. She felt like she should say something, but her mouth refused to work. The stranger stepped over the dead witch and into their house, the bloody knife still clutched in his hand. Anya scrambled away from him. Were they next? Suddenly, a trip to see the Tsar didn't seem so terrible. Her mother's arms around her shook Anya out of her stupor. How long had she just stared like a frightened rabbit?
It's okay, Kiska. This is an old friend of your father's. Fyodor is a member of the resistance. He's going to help us escape.
And we'd best be about it,
Fyodor said. He'd sheathed his knife and grabbed the dead witch by the ankle.
Is everything prepared as we discuss, Sasha?
Yes, we're ready,
her mother said. Fyodor dragged the witch into the dining room and dropped her leg. Next, he flipped the table over and smashed it to pieces. Anya's baked apple splattered on the floor.
What's he doing?
Anya watched, horrified, as the strange man set about destroying their meager furniture. Maybe this was all a nightmare and she'd wake up in her warm bed and get to start the day over. Mom let her go and came around to look her in the eye.
I'm sorry it had to be this way, Anya. But if we're to have any hope of getting away, we must do this.
Take her outside, Sosha,
Fyodor said.
I won't be much longer.
Mom reached into the hall closet and came out with a bag of her own. Anya stared at it. Had her mother planned all this? When? How? How did her mother know members of the resistance? She worked in the pillow factory, for heaven's sake. Her mother thrust her bag into her arms, grabbed her hand, and half-guided, half-dragged her out into the yard. A gleaming white van, long enough to carry 15 people, sat in the center of the driveway. A scale-covered fist decorated the door. It had to be the witch's transport. That van would have carried her away from everything she knew. Anya looked back at their little house. In the kitchen window, a flash of orange appeared. Fyodor hustled out the front door. For a big man, he moved right along.
Hurry,
he said.
The fire will bring the authorities soon enough.
Fire?
Anya noticed the smoke an instant after she spoke.
Why?
Mother tugged on her hand, and they followed Fyodor up the driveway and out to the rough dirt road. No one said anything as they quick-marched through the gravel. Anya glanced over her shoulder. They'd covered a quarter mile, but she could see the smoke billowing up as their house burned. She dug in her heels.
Someone tell me what's going on!
Her mother stopped and faced her, her eyes beyond sad.
I wouldn't let them have you too, Anya. Servants of the Tsar took your father from us. I refused to give up any more to them.
The clock is ticking, Sasha.
Fyodor had stopped a little ways up the road.
We need to reach the truck. You can tell her everything then.
Of course.
Mom looked deep into Anya's eyes.
Will you trust me a little longer, Kiska?
Anya trusted her mother to the end of the world. She nodded, and they hurried on their way. A mile from home, they turned down a rutted side path. Calling it a road seemed far too generous. They'd barely gone 100 yards when they reached a flatbed dual-wheel truck that used to be red, but now had more rust than anything. The bed of the truck held a load of summer vegetables piled into tan baskets. Fyodor yanked twice on the tailgate before it came free. He held out his hand and helped Mom up into the back. Once she was up, he looked at Anya and held his hand out to her. Should she trust this man? All she knew was that he wasn't afraid to kill. The image of blood gushing out of the witch's neck still burned in her memory. She steeled herself. Mom trusted him, and she trusted her mother. Anya put her hand in his calloused palm. With Fyodor's help, she clambered up into the back of the truck.
Help me, Anya.
Her mother had bent over and grabbed the handle of a basket filled with zucchini. Together, they shifted the container to reveal a small hiding space in the middle of the vegetables. She followed her mother inside, and Fyodor shoved the basket into place, leaving them in the shadowy interior. The grassy scent of fresh-picked vegetables surrounded them. The only light came from a few gaps in the basket stack. If anyone looked close, they'd see Anya and her mother hiding. But that seemed unlikely. As unlikely as a white witch being murdered on their front porch, and the two of them ending up on the run with a man she'd never seen before. Anya needed answers before her head exploded. Outside, the truck rumbled to life, jerked, and they started moving.
"You said you'd tell me everything," Anya said.
She couldn't see her mother's face in the dark, but she looked in that direction.
"I'm listening."
Anya used her hands and feet to try and brace herself as the truck rattled through ruts and potholes. The engine went from roar to rattle to screech, and she feared they might end up stranded God knew where. An especially hard lurch sent her sliding into her mother. Only the cloth of her dress prevented her from getting splinters in her butt. There had to be worse ways to travel, but in that moment she couldn't think of one. In the dark beside her, Mom blew out a sigh.
"Where should I begin?"
"At the beginning," Anya said. "How did you ever get mixed up with the resistance?"
"It wasn't that we wanted to, you know. Life in the Empire is hard. But your father and I managed, and were happy. Then I got pregnant. With me?" "That's right. It came as a shock since the doctor told me I'd never be able to have children. We thought of you as our little miracle. 5 months into the pregnancy, the doctor announced I was going to have a girl. I was so excited. Then I remembered your grandmother. Great-grandma Catherine? What made you think of her?"
Anya hadn't known her maternal great-grandmother beyond the fact that she left her a wardrobe that was now so much firewood.
"My grandmother had wizard potential like you. The white witches came for her when she turned 18. She'd already had my mother, but that brought no consideration from the witches."
"I still don't understand," Anya said.
"Magical ability runs in families. It skipped me and my mother. But when I found out I was having a girl, I feared the worst. I refused to have my little girl dragged away like Grandma Catherine. Your father agreed, and we set about preparing for the worst, while hoping the curse would skip another generation."
Another bump rattled Anya as she tried to wrap her mind around what her mother had told her. She found it hard to imagine magic running in her family. Before today, she would have sworn they were the most ordinary people in the Empire. She certainly didn't feel like a wizard. What did it feel like to be a wizard? She had no idea.
"Is it really a curse?"
Anya asked.
"In the Empire it is."
For a moment, her mother sounded tired beyond words. Anya wished there was enough light to make out her expression.
"Having magical ability is the one certain way to end up a slave of the Tsar. The White Witches serve as his elite enforcers. They travel the Empire executing his will, crushing anyone that dares speak their mind, when they're not too busy kidnapping girls to make yet more slaves."
"How do you know all this?"
A soft chuckle, almost drowned out by the roar of the engine.
18 years of preparation. I've spoken with many people over that time. We've let the resistance use our house as a rest stop on their travels. Since we had you, we weren't able to participate in many of the group's more active efforts. But sheltering those in need was something we could do.
I don't remember seeing any visitors.
No. There was a secret room in the basement, accessible from a hidden door outside. We did everything possible to keep our mission from you.
Why? Didn't you trust me?
It wasn't a matter of trust. Another sigh in the dark. You were a child. If you didn't know something, you couldn't speak of it. Even an innocent comment to one of your teachers might have meant all our deaths. When you grew up, it was already second nature to keep the comings and goings a secret. So we kept up the practice. Joining the resistance was our choice, Anya. We didn't want you to suffer for it.
The truck rattled to a stop, cutting her next question off.
What's going on?
Shh. Mom shifted, and the light from one of the small gaps vanished. When the light reappeared, she whispered,
"A checkpoint. Don't make a sound."
Anya's heart thudded so hard, she feared that alone might give them away. She held her breath and listened like she'd never listened before.
"State your name and business,"
a bored voice said.
"Fyodor Volkovich. I'm on my way to Mosa to deliver a load of vegetables."
After a moment of silence, he added,
"I come by here twice a week. Don't you ever get tired of this song and dance? It puts food on the table. Can't be fussy at my age. Running kind of late today, aren't you, Fyodor?"
Still bored, but now a hint of curiosity, Anya doubted that was anything they wanted from an official.
"You're telling me. I spent 3 hours on the side of the road this morning trying to get this piece of junk running again. It'll be a small miracle if I make it home before dark."
A humorless laugh from the official.
"I won't keep you then."
A moment later, the truck rumbled into motion. Anya peeked out one of the gaps and caught just a glimpse of a man in a white uniform holding a clipboard and making notes. Beside her, Mom groaned.
"That was close."
"Won't there be an inspection when we reach Mosa?"
Anya asked.
"Yes, but we won't be on the truck when it arrives."
For the next half an hour, they bounced along on a slightly less rough road, and Anya's mother told her about the resistance and how they became more and more involved. Anya could only shake her head at the secret life her parents led. There was one thing she had to know, and while she feared it would be hard for her mother to talk about, she needed to ask.
"How did Dad die?" "He was killed, helping a resistance agent on one of his delivery runs."
Mom sniffed, and Anya imagined the tears running down her cheeks. Anya felt around their little compartment until she found her mother's hand and gave it a squeeze. Mom squeezed back and cleared her throat.
"One of the reasons they agreed to help us was because your father took a job at the cannery. The delivery truck gave him a perfect excuse to travel all over the county. They built a compartment to hide people or supplies under the books. He didn't have a package every trip, just now and then. It was bad luck that on the day one of the witches was doing an inspection, he was carrying a spy. She found the hidden compartment and killed both your father and the spy."
"Why didn't they come after us?"
Anya asked.
"He worked under a false name, and when the witch killed him, there wasn't..."
Mom's voice caught, and she was silent for a few seconds.
there wasn't enough left to identify. It isn't unusual for people to disappear. So when your father vanished, no one thought much of it. Just another unlucky soul caught up in something the Empire didn't like. So what happens now? Now we take the long trail out of the Empire. When we've escaped, you'll be the first wizard to have ever gotten out. Many powerful people will want to talk to us about the Empire. What we know is our bargaining chip. Don't tell them anything until we're safe. How long will the trip take?
Anya had studied geography in school, of course. The nearest free nation was the Kingdom of the Isles. But how long it would take to get there was another matter altogether.
If all goes according to plan, we should be in London by the middle of August. What if things don't go according to plan?
The truck rattled to a stop. Maybe that was just as well. Anya didn't really want to think about what might happen if they failed. The truck bed rocked and shifted, and a moment later, the basket was dragged to one side. Anya squinted against the glare.
Quickly,
Fyodor said.
We don't want to be seen on the side of the road.
Anya crawled out and stood up, her legs and back complaining after being cooped up for so long. Her mother climbed out behind her, and the three of them hopped down. They'd stopped at the edge of a battered blacktop road. There was no one around for as far as she could see in either direction. She took that as a good sign. At the edge of the shoulder, a clump of evergreen bushes rustled and slipped aside, revealing a young man, perhaps 3 years older than Anya. He wore coarse wool pants, a brown jacket, and a fisherman's cap. Fyodor motioned them toward the newly made gap in the shrubbery. Mom took Anya's hand, and they hustled down to the stranger. He exchanged a nod with her mother, and then they were past. A well-worn trail led away from the road and deeper into the shadowy evergreen forest. Anya shivered and tried not to think of the stories Dad used to tell about ghosts and wolves that liked nothing better than to eat little girls. She tightened her grip on her bag and tried to peer into the surrounding shadows. They were only stories. Nothing to worry about. Mom stopped and turned toward the road. Fyodor passed his keys over to the new guy and joined Anya and her mother on the trail.
Darko will take the truck the rest of the way.
Fyodor took the lead, and they started down the path.
If they search, they will find nothing but a poorly packed load of vegetables.
Where are we going now?
Anya asked.
Over the foothills into the next county. Others will be waiting to take us to the train depot. A friend has arranged transport to the port of Anapa.
And then?
Anya skipped over an exposed route. If she didn't take care, she'd break her neck and save the Imperial agents the trouble of executing her.
A ship across the Black Sea to Constanta.
Anya's eyes nearly bugged out of her head.
We're going through the land of Night Princes? That's insane! We won't last a night!
Fyodor waved a dismissive hand.
The princes hate the Tsar almost as much as we do. They've been a great ally in our fight. I've spoken to Prince Talon myself, and he agreed to grant us safe passage all the way to the German border. In fact, that part of the journey may be the safest leg.
Anya's mind reeled. What did it say about the rest of their journey if traveling 1,000 miles through vampire-infested countryside was the safest part? 2. Investigation begins. The house was a burned-up, gutted wreck. A trickle of smoke continued to rise from the remains, tickling the back of Yarik's throat. He wasn't an expert, but even he could tell someone set the blaze. Only a few charred boards remained standing, most of the building having fallen into the basement. He shook his head. Not much to be learned there. Ignoring the charred stink filling the air, he left the boys, two junior agents on a rotation through the county office, to pick through the ruins and turned his attention to the government van parked in the gravel driveway. A white witch had signed it out. He hadn't bothered to memorize the woman's name. If you'd met one of the witches, you'd met them all. In fact, Yarek had seen corpses with more variation in personality. If you liked your women arrogant, dismissive, and powerful, you'd love a witch. Otherwise, forget it. He pulled the door open and found a clipboard sitting on the driver's seat. It held a single piece of paper with a list of names. The first six had an X beside the name. The seventh name was Anya Kazakov, the only daughter of Sasha Kazakov, the registered occupant of this property. Yarek tossed the clipboard on the seat. Clearly, her testing of Miss Kazakov hadn't gone according to plan. Now he was stuck figuring out what went wrong. Damn witches. Nothing but trouble, the lot of them. Agent Yarek! One of his boys, he'd given up trying to learn their names since they'd be gone in 6 months anyway, stood in the rubble and waved his arms. Yarek's back popped when he stretched it. He marched over to the edge of the ruined house.
What?
We found a skull, sir.
Anything else?
He held up a charred length of wood. Even from a distance, Yarek could see the crystals set into it. Damn witches.
Beg the skull and the stick. We've got a dead witch on our hands, boys. We need to find whoever did this and find them first.
If they didn't, they'd have an army of the mad women crawling all over the county, making life even more miserable. Yarek left the boys to finish combing through the house and walked over to his cramped government car. It had been white at some point in its life. Every damn thing associated with the government was. But now age and dirt had combined to turn it a sort of yellowish tan. Looked about like what he used to find in his son's diapers. His throat tightened, and he dismissed the memory. Best not to think about Yuri. He'd been dead for 12 years. But try as he might, Yarek still couldn't let go. Focus on the job. That was the thing to do. He wedged himself behind the wheel and loosened his tie. Whoever had designed the cheap piece of junk hadn't had 6'2", 300-pound men in mind. At least it started on the first try. He pulled out of the drive and turned right up the dirt road. Of all the counties in the empire, why did a witch have to die in his? There were over 100 counties, and the emperor only knew how many witches. Yet he had the horrid luck for this to happen. He bounced through one of the many ruts and grimaced. If he had to search all the miserable back roads, it was going to be a long afternoon. 20 miles up the road, he reached the nearest checkpoint. It wasn't much, just two teenagers in white uniforms sitting beside an orange sawhorse. Yarek rolled down his window and dug out his identification. The blonde boy looked at his official seal, then at Yarek's face, then to the seal again. Finally, he gathered himself enough to ask,
"Can we help you with something, sir? Has Anya Kazakov or her mother come this way?" "No, sir. We saw smoke."
The second guard joined his partner beside Yarek's car.
"Was it the Kazakov's place?" "Fred, so. You know them?" "Not personally, sir. Anya was 2 years behind me at school. I knew her by sight, but we didn't hang out or anything." "All the boys knew Anya by sight."
The second guard gave a wolf whistle.
She's the most beautiful girl in the county. Can you give me a description?
Yarek asked more out of curiosity about what they'd say than any need to know. He could call the school and have a picture in 5 minutes. The first guard said,
Blonde hair, blue eyes, everything else perfect.
The other boy gave an enthusiastic nod.
She's surface of the sun hot. Do they have family in the area? Somewhere they might go if there was an accident. Not that I know of,
Guard One said.
Okay, keep your eyes open. If you see either of the women, take them into custody. We need to ask them some questions about the fire.
Both boys saluted and returned to their posts. Yerik had seen less inspiring servants of the Empire, but he couldn't recall where. He made a U-turn and drove back down the road. It was 50 miles to the checkpoint in the opposite direction. 50 miles of pockmarked, rutted dirt road. Damn witches. Yarik turned off what passed for a main road and onto a secondary road that had just a few less craters than the moon. After striking out at the second checkpoint, he only had one option remaining. If Anya and her mother didn't come this way, he was flat out of ideas. As he approached yet another checkpoint, this one manned by a graybeard old enough to be his father, Yarik's radio crackled before a staticky voice said,
We found a hidden room in the basement, sir. It appears the Kazakovs may have been resistance sympathizers. We found no sign of other bodies. What are your orders, sir?
Yarik stopped and snatched the mic off its holder.
For one thing, stop using the radio. If the resistance is involved, they monitor government frequencies. When you're finished there, take the witch's van to base. I'll be there as soon as I can. Should anything else come up, call my cell. Yes, sir.
The radio went quiet, and Yerik gave a disgusted shake of his head.
Morons. He'd fire the both of them if he could.
Unfortunately, they weren't qualified to do anything useful, so he was stuck with them, at least for a few more months. Then they'd be someone else's problem. He put the car in gear and eased onto the road. When he reached the checkpoint, this one was literally an old man with a walking stick and clipboard. He stopped and rolled his window down. The old man hobbled over and looked through the window at him. Yarik flashed his ID.
Has anyone come through here today? Yeah.
A headache was slowly building now.
Who?
The guard's neck creaked as he turned to look at the clipboard.
Fyodor Volkovich. He had a load of vegetables bound for the plant. Fyodor's a good boy. Comes through here a couple times a week. Always has a minute to chat. Not today, though, running late. He ought to request a new truck. That piece of junk he's driving is on its last legs. Wait, I remember back in the old... What time did he come through?
Yarik asked. Once the old-timers got going, you had to be quick, or they'd never shut up.
12:47. I know just what time it was because I checked my watch.
The guard dug a silver watch out of his pocket.
I got it when I left the army. Served 10 years on the eastern border, fighting the Iron Emperor's stone soldiers.
The guard blathered on, but Yarik stopped listening. The first signs of smoke were called in a little after noon. If Fyodor was involved, the timing was right.
You had to use a bazooka to destroy them stone soldiers. I was just a rifleman. Never did get to fire one of the rocket launchers. Why, I bet... Did Fyodor have anyone with him? What? No, of course not. Why would he have anyone with him? I told you, he had a load of vegetables for the plant. Did you search the load? No. I'm just supposed to note the name and time of anyone passing through. No one said anything about searching. If I'm supposed to search, someone needs to tell me. I can search, all right. Did I tell you about the time? I need to get moving. Good afternoon.
Yerrick rolled up his window, cutting off the stream of words. He pulled out around the old man and drove as fast as he dared down the rutted path. The cannery was in Mosa. If he hurried, Yerrick figured he could make it before shift change. As he drove, he flipped open his phone and hit auto dial. A moment later, a female voice said,
Security Station 53. How may I direct your call?
Research.
One moment.
The line went dead, and a moment later, another voice, this one male, said,
Research. Is that you, Rostov?
Yerrick asked.
Agent Yerrick, it's been a while since I heard from you. How can I help? I need anything you have on Fyodor Volkovich, especially as it regards a family called Kazakov or the local resistance. Got it. This has something to do with the dead witch. Looks like. Call me when you have something. Don't use the radio. Understood.
The line went dead, and Yerrick flipped the phone shut. Rostov was the best researcher in the department. Not that that meant much, since they only had two researchers. Rostov and his brother, Sergei. Still, if there was something to be found, he had confidence Rostov would find it. An hour later, Yerrick reached the edge of Mosa. The town consisted of grids of cinder block apartment buildings, cinder block shops, a few smaller factories, and the cannery. Two roads ran north and south, one straight to the cannery. At his first real checkpoint of the day, a pair of guards armed with machine guns stood beside a little shack with a gate attached to it. They passed a cigarette back and forth and ignored Yerrick. Clearly, they didn't recognize his government-issue vehicle. Yerrick rolled down his window and thrust his credentials at them. Fear quickly replaced arrogant indifference. That was the correct reaction when you made a superior wait. Yerrick knew plenty of agents that lacked his good nature. His old boss, for instance, would have had these two idiots transferred to the Eastern Front in a heartbeat if they'd kept him waiting. The cigarette was quickly stamped out, and both guards hurried over.
How can we be of assistance, Agent?
Asked the older of the two, a young man with a patchy beard and frayed uniform.
I'm looking for Fyodor Volkovich. He was headed this way with a load of vegetables for the cannery.
The older guard looked to his companion, who trotted over to the guard shack. He reached inside and pulled out a clipboard. He flipped the pages once, nodded, and jogged over to the car.
I found him. Came through just before 2. Nothing unusual in my notes.
Yerrick nodded and gestured at the gate. The guards hastened to open it for him. When the bar was up, he drove through and straight down to the cannery, where he stopped at yet another checkpoint.
It was a damned wonder they got anything done in the Empire. Everyone was always stopping to talk to guards.
He completed the ritual presentation of identification, and a middle-aged man leaned against the hood of his car.
Can I help you, Agent? Fyodor Volkovich. He came through at 2. Do you remember him?
The guard shrugged.
We get deliveries all day long. I can't keep track of who's who. As long as they've got vegetables and are on my list, I let them through. What time did he leave?
The guard gave a put-upon groan and stepped into his shack. If the Empire had a stock market, Yerrick would have invested in guard shack and uniform makers. The guard emerged again.
He left 15 minutes ago. You just missed him. What did he look like?
The guard gazed up at the sky and tapped his chin.
Young lad, mid
20s, maybe. No beard. Had a funny head, like sailors wear.
Yerek nodded, snatched his radio mic from its cradle, and switched to the local frequency.
Guard station one, come in.
A moment of static was followed by a crackly voice.
This is guard station one, go ahead. This is Agent Yerek. Stop any truck attempting to leave the town. Understood? Yes, Agent. How long do you want us to hold them? Until I've spoken to the drivers. I'm on my way now.
Yerek repeated his message to guard station two and turned towards the edge of town. One of them was bound to catch Fyodor. Maybe now he'd get some of his questions answered. The guard shack had been reduced to splinters. Empty baskets lay scattered across the road. At least the guards themselves managed to leap aside when the delivery truck refused to stop. They appeared shaken, but no worse for wear. Yerek scrubbed a hand across his face. There was no sign of the truck that had done the running down. Any doubts he'd had about Fyodor's involvement with the resistance vanished. Unfortunately, that meant he was going to have to call regional headquarters. Standing orders were to report all resistance activity at once. No way would he avoid a visit from the witches now. Why had he decided to join internal security? Yerek asked himself that more and more often as he got older. Not that he had a choice in the matter now. Once you made your career selection, that was that. He'd work until he was dead or unable to do the job any longer. That meant another 20 years of this shit at least. He groaned, heaved himself out of his undersized car, and ambled over to the trembling guards. They clutched their rifles like they were some sort of magical talisman that would keep them safe.
Did you get a good look at him?
Yerek asked. The older guard shook his head.
Sir was a glare on the windshield. Plus, I was more focused on the grill about to flatten me. The truck was an old flatbed filled with empty baskets.
Great. That describes half the trucks in the county. Either of you get overshot?
Both men shook their heads. No great surprise there. Neither of them had ever seen any real action. Not with a posting in this backwoods county. He waved them off and went to examine the remains of the shack. Yerek had no idea what he was looking for. Inspiration, maybe. A portal to some other part of the world? Either would do, but neither seemed likely. Something wet glinted in the late afternoon light. He bent down and touched it. Dark and a little tacky. Oil, maybe. Not antifreeze. Not the right color. If the oil pan got busted, that was a break for Yerek. A trail of drops led down the road. If it was oil, the truck wouldn't get far. Maybe he could get a few answers before he had to call headquarters.
Hey!
When the guards looked his way, he waved.
Get in! We're going hunting!
They hustled over with their rifles.
Shouldn't we stay here?
The older guard asked.
No, this is a priority. Remember, we need Fyodor alive.
Otherwise, he'd have to ask one of the witches to question his corpse. Yerek had been to a necromantic questioning once, and the memory still gave him chills. The guards slid into the back, and Yerek got behind the wheel. They had about an hour of daylight left. He took off down the road. With any luck, they'd find their man sitting on the shoulder, ready to surrender. Right. And maybe he'd find a sane witch to help him identify the skull. The first bullet skipped off the windshield, sending a spiderweb of cracks racing through it. Yerek slammed on the brakes and skidded sideways. 50 feet up the road, a flatbed truck, older than he was, sat on the shoulder. A second shot smashed into the passenger side window and blew it to shards. The younger guard stuck his rifle out the window and opened up on the truck. The acrid stink of cordite filled the car. The crack of the machine gun nearly deafened Yerik. He drew his service revolver, scrambled out of the car, and eased over to put the engine block between him and whoever was doing the shooting. When the machine gun finally fell silent, Yerik chanced a glance around the front of his car. No one shot at him. On the one hand, he was relieved. On the other, he feared his overzealous companion may have killed his only lead. He caught the older guard's eye and pointed at the rear of the car. Then he pointed at himself and nodded toward the front. The guard gave him a thumbs up and eased around the trunk. Yerik broke cover and ran toward the bullet-riddled truck. Still no shots. After the machine gun, the silence seemed almost oppressive. He hopped up on the step and pointed his gun into the cab. Empty. No blood, no Fyodor.
Sir!
The guard said. Yerik landed on the pavement and ran for the back of the truck. On the opposite side from the road, he found the guard standing over a body. A single bullet hole in the side of his head answered one question. The dead man had an automatic pistol in his limp grasp. He'd clearly preferred death to capture. Yerik didn't blame him. He was no more enamored of the witch's interrogation of the living than he was of their questioning of the dead.
Damn it!
He restrained himself from kicking the corpse by a hair.
What now, sir?
The guard asked.
Now, you two load this asshole in my car, and I take him to headquarters. I might not be able to question him, but the witches can.
An hour later, Yerik pulled into the Imperial Security Agency headquarters and drove around to the rear where a set of steel double doors led to the morgue. A single flickering bulb lit the entrance. He got out, marched up the ramp, and pushed the buzzer. A moment later, a voice asked,
"Who is it?" "Yerik, I need the body haulers out here with a gurney." "On our way, sir."
Yerik returned to his car and sat on the cooling hood. The day hadn't gone at all well. He accepted that. A good day in the Empire involved keeping your head down, avoiding witches and resistance fighters, and getting home in time to enjoy your wife's dinner. So far, he'd failed on all counts. He checked the time on his phone. Half an hour until dinner. Nope, not tonight. He called to let Ileana know he wouldn't make it while he waited for the body haulers. She wouldn't like it, but at this point his dear wife had resigned herself to his work hours.
"Where are you?"
she asked.
"The stew's almost ready."
"You'll have to warm it up for me later. I'm going to be late."
His voice must have given something away.
"Bad day?"
"Very."
The door opened, and two big men wearing white coveralls emerged, pushing a gurney with a squeaky wheel.
"I have to go. Love you."
"Love you too."
He closed his phone and walked around to watch the haulers load up Fyodor. They each grabbed an end and slung him up and out of the trunk. A shallow puddle of blood filled the metal of his trunk. As he stared, it slowly drained out a small hole that had rusted through the bottom over the years. He'd get a rookie to hose it out and be good to go in the morning.
"What do you want us to do with the stiff?"
one of them asked.
"Cold storage. We'll get the witch to look at him in the morning."
That drew a grunt. The staff didn't like the witches any better than the agents. Yerik followed them inside, taking the first left into the main area of the building. He spotted Rostov working at his desk and went over.
"Find anything?"
Rostov looked up from the computer and peered at Yerik through thick, round glasses. He blinked as though trying to remember what he was supposed to find. Then finally, an invisible light bulb appeared.
"Yes, I put a full report together for you."
Rostov shuffled through the stack of files balanced precariously on the edge of his desk, and finally yanked one out.
There you are. Everything I could find on Fyodor Volkovich.
Yarek accepted the folder. It only had about 3 pages.
This is it?
What can I say? Friend Fyodor has lived an exceptionally boring life. Dead wife, no kids. Just work and regular visits to the Sickle, a cheap bar in Mosa.
Yarek flipped open the file and stared at the picture on the first page. The man had a beard, looked about 20 years older and 100 pounds heavier than the body he'd just brought in.
You got the wrong guy,
Yarek said.
I assure you I didn't,
Rostov said.
The first page is his official registration downloaded directly from the computer in New St. Petersburg. The picture was updated, along with all his other information, 2 years ago. That is Fyodor Volkovich.
Yarek scowled at the picture. If that was Fyodor, then who the hell did they have in the fridge? He returned to his desk and tried to make sense of what he knew. The dead guy was impersonating Fyodor. No great challenge there, since the various checkpoints only noted the name you provided. They didn't have pictures of every person in the Empire at their fingertips. The point of the whole exercise eluded Yarek. And for that matter, where were the Kazakov ladies? No one had so much as mentioned either woman, and from the sounds of it, the daughter at least would draw attention. He tossed the slender file on his empty desk for later reading and slumped down into the hard plastic chair. What a mess. There was no way around it. He'd have to call for a witch now. Yarek snatched the handset out of its cradle. No sense putting it off. He dialed the regional command center, and after 3 rings, a voice said,
Command center, how can I direct your call?
The witch ward,
Yarek said. A moment of silence, then,
Hold on.
A beep followed a click. Yarek waited, a little bead of sweat forming on his upper lip. They always made you wait. It was a way of asserting their power. Finally, a cold voice said,
Magic section, what do you need?
I have a possibly murdered white witch on my hands, as well as an unidentified body of a young male that was likely involved. I'm requesting a necromantic intervention.
You're certain the victim is a witch?
Yarek wouldn't have thought it was possible to get a chill through the phone. But he shivered nonetheless.
I'm as certain as I can be without magical confirmation. Could you get someone here by morning?
A loud crack was followed by a chill wind swirling through the open space. At the center of the swirling breeze stood a pale woman with white hair, wearing a white robe. It looked like someone had sucked all the color out of the witch. They all looked like that, though, so he wasn't overly concerned.
Never mind.
Yarek stood and walked over to greet his unwelcome visitor.
Thank you for coming, so...
Where is my sister's body?
Eyes as hard as diamonds bore into Yarek.
Burned up, I'm afraid. All we recovered was her skull and the testing device she carried.
Someone dared burn the body of a white witch.
The temperature dropped 20 degrees.
Who? We don't know. That's why I called you. I had a lead, but he killed himself rather than submit to my questions. The only way we can extract any information now is with magic.
I will discover who did this. And when I do, they'll wish they'd never been born.
Yarek didn't doubt that for a second. It probably wasn't appropriate, but he found he pitied the poor bastard that killed the witch. Yerik walked down the hall toward the morgue, trying his best to ignore the cold radiating in waves off the witch. He'd have icicles hanging off his nose at this rate. A dying light above him flickered and sent crazy shadows dancing around them. How many times had he told maintenance to get that fixed?
Stop trying to distract yourself and focus.
He pushed through a set of double doors and into a stainless steel and tile operating room. Beyond a barrier of hanging plastic strips, a wall covered in little doors waited. The body haulers had made themselves scarce, chicken-hearted bastards, so he'd have to handle everything himself.
Who did you want to see first?
My sister.
She glared at him, as though the answer should have been obvious, even to an idiot like him. And it should have been. The witches only cared for their own, and their master, the Czar, may he rule forever. Yerik scanned the rows of doors until he found one that read, Unknown Witch. He opened it and pulled out a steel slab with the bagged skull and charred length of wood resting on it. The witch approached, and Yerik gave her room to work. In fact, he inched as far away as he dared without leaving the room. She pulled out the blackened skull, ignoring the few scraps of flesh still clinging to it, and stared into its empty eye sockets. He had no idea what she hoped to find, and he didn't want to know. A new chill, this one psychic rather than physical, filled the air when she spoke the first word of her spell. Dark energy gathered around the skull, flickering and popping like black lightning. It lifted out of her grasp and hovered at eye level. She continued to chant, and the darkness deepened until Yerik could barely make out the skull itself. When she finally fell silent, shadows filled the morgue. Yerik couldn't see the plastic wall or the little metal doors. There was only him, the witch, and the skull. There wasn't another pair in the world he would have less liked to spend his evening with.
Who killed your sister?
The witch asked. The only sound was Yerik's hammering heart. When he began to fear the spell hadn't worked, an unearthly voice said,
I don't know. Did you see them?
No.
Yerik grimaced. So far, this was a spectacular failure. The witch looked his way.
Do you have questions?
He bit his lip and thought.
Did Anya or her mother do anything to you?
No.
That was a relief. Perhaps they had witnessed the murder and ran for it. But in that case, he should have found them by now.
Were you in the house when you were attacked?
In the doorway.
Facing in?
Yes.
Yerik nodded, and the witch ended her spell. The skull landed on the steel table, and the oppressive darkness dissolved. She stared at him.
You learned something.
Yeah. Whoever killed your sister moved the body deeper into the house before setting the place on fire. The murderer wanted to be sure the body was destroyed.
Why?
She asked.
I could have recalled her spirit even without the skull. It only simplified my task.
Most people aren't that knowledgeable about magic. It's a reasonable precaution for the uninitiated. Unfortunately, we're no closer to figuring out who actually killed your colleague.
True. But we will find whoever did this, agent. I promise you no one can get away with killing a white witch. We won't stand for it, and neither will the Czar.
Wouldn't want anyone to think you weren't invincible after all.
Out loud, he said,
I have no doubt we'll find and bring the killer to justice. Perhaps the second body will provide us with more information than your unfortunate sister.
Perhaps.
Show me the body.
Yerek pushed the slab with the witch's skull into its niche and pulled out the one holding the mystery man. The body haulers hadn't bothered to remove his clothes or cover him with a cloth. Even a criminal deserved more dignity than that. The witch repeated her spell, once more filling the morgue with darkness. Even knowing exactly what was going to happen didn't make Yerek any more comfortable. She turned to him and said,
"Ask your questions."
"Who are you?"
"Darko Donovich."
The sepulchral voice seemed to come from everywhere, rather than from the dead man's lips.
"Why were you pretending to be Fyodor?"
When the spirit didn't answer for half a minute, Yerek looked at the witch and raised an eyebrow.
"His spirit resists the spell."
She spoke a single harsh syllable. A low moan filled the air, a moan of anguish beyond human understanding. When the spirit spoke again, its tone sounded even flatter and more emotionless.
"Fyodor had another mission. I had to complete his delivery."
"What mission?"
"The resistance is helping Anya Kazakov and her mother escape the Empire." "Why?"
the witch asked.
"To show that the Tsar isn't all-powerful and resistance isn't futile. Her escape will prove we have a chance and give others hope."
Her lips twisted in rage. But when she didn't ask any more questions, Yerek resumed the interrogation.
"What's their plan?"
"To help her escape."
"By what route? What mode of transportation?"
"I don't know. The details were kept from all but those who needed to know."
The voice grew softer as it went on.
"Time runs short, Agent,"
the witch said.
"My spell is weakening."
"Where exactly did you last see Anya, and what was she doing?"
30 miles south of Mosa on the side of the road. Fyodor was to lead the girl and her mother through the forest to the next point on the journey. I took the truck from there to Mosa."
The word Mosa became a drawn-out sigh, and the oppressive atmosphere vanished. The witch snapped her fingers, and the darkness fled.
"That was not so useful."
"On the contrary, we now have a place to start and an idea of what's going on. That's more than I had 10 minutes ago. I'll send out an alert to all stations to watch out for our fugitives. And first thing in the morning, we'll begin the search for wherever they left the road. Since they're on foot, they won't have too much of a lead on us."
"It had better be as you say. I will be joining your search. My name is Ermina Mercer, and the killer of my sister will not escape. I swear it in the Tsar's name."
Yerek kept his expression neutral, but inside he groaned. Just what he needed. A witch to criticize every move he made. 3. Rebels on the Run. Anya wasn't sure she could take another step. For the past, she didn't know how many hours, she'd been trudging along behind her mother and Fyodor. The baked apple felt like a dream from another life, a life that still made some sort of sense. Now she was on the run, and she'd given up asking her mother for more details 3 hours ago when she discovered she needed all her breath for marching. The sun hung low in the sky, and the trees cast long shadows across the narrow trail. Roots and loose rock hid, waiting to send her sprawling on her face. So far, she'd avoided an embarrassing spill, but Anya was no outdoors woman. She didn't like bugs, or dirt, or camping, and she was getting to despise hiking. If they had to walk all the way to the train yard, she might take her chances with the witches. Or at least, she might have if Fyodor hadn't killed the one that came for her. If they got their hands on her now, Anya doubted she'd receive gentle treatment. No. Whatever came of this mad plan, she had no choice but to see it through. 5 minutes later, faint sounds filled the air. It sounded like voices, but who in the world would be out in the middle of the forest? She found out a moment later when they rounded a bend and the trail opened up into a clearing. A handful of fires burned, and the scent of roasted meat set her mouth to watering. She hadn't eaten anything since breakfast, and found she was starving.
"What is this?"
she asked.
"A resistance camp,"
Fyodor said.
"We'll be picking up some help before we continue our journey in the morning. You two must be hungry. We'll eat, and then perhaps we can answer your many questions."
Getting answers seemed a good deal less important at the moment than eating. Fyodor led them into the clearing. A young man in gray carrying a machine gun approached, and after a few words, motioned them through. They went to the nearest fire. A woman tended a bubbling pot, stirring it with a wooden spoon. Anya stared for a moment. She hadn't expected to find women mixed in with the rebels. Though why it should surprise her, she didn't know. Her own mother had gotten involved with the group after all. The cook offered a gap-toothed smile and ladled up a bowl of stew for her. Anya accepted it, along with a bent spoon, and set to eating. The gravy had a mild spice she didn't recognize, and the meat fell apart when she cut it. After hours of hiking, it tasted like the finest meal in the world. She'd emptied half the bowl before Anya realized she hadn't thanked the woman.
"This is delicious. Thank you."
"You're welcome, dear."
Anya glanced at her mother and found she was engrossed in conversation with one of the rebels, probably someone she'd met at the house. Anya returned her attention to the cook.
"I didn't expect to find women in the group. Do you mind if I ask why you joined the resistance?"
The cook's gentle expression turned hard, and for a moment, Anya feared she'd said something she shouldn't have. The grim look lasted only a moment, then a sigh blew it away.
"I joined because my daughter was like you, a wizard candidate. The witches took her from me, and I haven't seen her since. That was 5 years ago, and God only knows where she is and what they've done to her. When I heard of the mission to help you escape, I volunteered at once. If I can save you."
The woman sniffed and looked away. Anya wasn't sure what to say, so she returned to her meal. Try as she might, Anya couldn't imagine life anywhere else. All she'd ever known was the Empire and their little house, an equally small school and her few friends. It wasn't a perfect life, but until today she'd been fairly content. Anya cleaned her bowl and yawned. Desire for sleep warred with her need to know exactly what was going on. Mom finished her discussion and turned to face her. It looked like answers would be the winner. Fyodor shifted, completing their little semicircle.
"You wished to know more of our plans,"
he said.
"Here they are. We mean to smuggle you out of the Empire, across Europe to the Kingdom of the Isle. We've spent 10 years laying plans and preparing for this moment."
Anya stared, stunned by what he said. 10 years the Resistance had been planning this? All she knew about the place was what she learned in school. The teachers said they were a weak, decadent nation that allowed their people to decide who represented them and let their wizards run free. It didn't seem so bad to her, especially now that she was one of those wizards.
"Why now?
Why me? She asked.
Our contacts in the kingdom requested we bring out a wizard,
Fyodor said.
They're curious about how powerful you are, without the Tsar's curse twisting your magic. Their words, not mine. Of course, we didn't know until today that you would be the one we brought out. Sosha volunteered to live with us if you passed the test. When you did, things happened quickly.
So what next?
In the morning, we set out for Dorcha, where we'll hop a train to Anapa. That'll take at least 10 days.
I can't believe they'd go out of their way just to meet an uncorrupted witch. Fyodor barked a laugh.
Hardly. We've prepared documents that reveal everything we know about the Empire. You're just the icing on the cake. Your presence tipped the scales in our direction.
Her head spun. It was all too much. Anya looked to her mother, who had a sad smile.
I refuse to let them have you, she said.
Anya nodded, curled up in a little ball, and hoped everything made more sense in the morning. The dawn light revealed a most welcome sight to Anya. 4 crudely built dune buggies. They looked like piles of scrap someone bolted wheels to, but they had engines, so at least she wasn't going to have to hike all the way to Dorcha. She sat up and groaned. Sleeping on the ground hadn't done her back or neck any good. She got to her feet, and her spine popped. Her mouth tasted like a family of mice had moved in, but there didn't appear to be anywhere to get washed up or brush her teeth. A quick glance around the clearing revealed the rebels in all their dubious glory. 11 men and women dressed in tattered clothes crouched around last night's fire pits. The men had scruffy beards, and the women's hair was a tangled mess. She reached up and found her own hair in a similar state. They'd seemed more impressive last night, sitting in the dark, tending their fires. In the harsh light of day, it became clear that they were desperate, ragged people straddling the line between survival and starvation. At least they all had guns. The sight did little to fill her with confidence. On the other hand, they didn't look like they had much to lose, so maybe that would motivate them to overcome their circumstances. For her and her mother's sake, she certainly hoped so.
Good morning, Kiska.
She'd been so wrapped up in her thoughts, Anya hadn't even noticed her mother approach. A familiar hand squeezed her shoulders, and she reached up and squeezed back. At least Mom was here. That fact made her feel better than it probably should have.
Hi, Mom. Did you sleep? A little.
Gentle pressure brought Anya around to face her. In her free hand, Mom held a biscuit studded with cheese.
Breakfast?
Anya accepted the food and bit down. Flaky goodness filled her mouth and brought a happy groan. Nothing like hunger to make the food taste delicious. All around her, people were packing and scattering the remains of the fires. It wouldn't do much to hide the fact that they'd camped here, but every little bit helped. She sighed and finished her meal. How did they make something so tasty out here? Her mother held out a blue leather booklet.
This is your new identity. Memorize it and burn the one you brought from home. The only thing worse than getting caught with false documents would be getting caught with both new and old papers.
Anya flipped open the booklet. Anya Ventarova. At least they let her keep her first name. Probably a good idea, lest she forget to answer to a new one. Anya was common enough that it shouldn't draw a second look. She dug her old book out of her bag, found a still-burning fire, and tossed it in. Just like their house, it went up in flames. No going back now. Half an hour later, They were roaring down a rough road cut through the pines by heavy equipment years ago. Anya sat beside Fyodor, who drove the best of the dune buggies, a four-seater with a proper roll cage. On the back seat, her mother and another man she didn't know crowded together. Not the most comfortable arrangement, but it beat walking.
"When can I drive?"
Anya shouted over the roar of the engine. Fyodor shot her a dubious look, but didn't refuse outright. Not that she expected him to give in easily. This wasn't a pleasure trip, after all. They traveled over the rough paths all morning until a little after noon when Fyodor slowed. They rounded a bend and found a shack not much bigger than an outhouse, built of rough logs, moss, and vines. The dune buggies came to a stop beside the shack, and Anya jumped out. Her legs almost gave out after hours of sitting in the cramped seat. She looked left and right, her knees locked together. A gentle tap on the shoulder got her to turn around. The woman that cooked for her the night before had left her transport and come over.
"You'll have to use the bushes, dear. No bathrooms out here."
Anya grimaced, but ran over behind a clump of low bushes. When she finished, she returned to the group in time to see Fyodor emerge from the shack. He was scowling and his fists clenched and relaxed like he wanted to strangle someone. The rest of the group busied themselves filling the buggies from bright red gas cans. Anya reached her mother at the same time Fyodor did. Two of the others joined them. No one had introduced themselves to her, and she figured that was intentional. She couldn't tell what she didn't know, after all.
"Bednos?"
Mom asked.
"Darko didn't make the rendezvous last night. Our mole says a witch arrived early yesterday evening. If we have to assume they know our plans."
"How much did Darko know?"
Mom asked.
"No details, just that we planned to smuggle the two of you out of the Empire. That's still enough to cause us trouble. They'll have lookouts posted on all the roads. That shouldn't be a big deal since we're traveling cross-country, but when we reach Dorcha, things could get dicey."
"Let's not borrow trouble,"
Mom said.
"We're days from reaching the city. Plenty might still go wrong between here and there."
Fyodor grunted.
"True enough. Load up. We've got a long ways to go."
Yerek stood, arms crossed, and surveyed the clearing. Six cold fire pits, matted down hay. A large group had camped there for several nights. They were long gone now, but it seemed clear that this was where the true Fyodor had led Anya and her mother. They were still a step behind, and Yerek hated being behind. Noon had come and gone an hour ago. If only they'd managed to find the path sooner. He shook his head at the useless wish. His men had done their best, and he couldn't ask for more than that. His stomach grumbled, and he pulled out one of the peanut butter crackers he'd grabbed from the vending machine before they left. He'd barely popped it in his mouth when one of his men shouted,
"Sir, we found something!"
Chewing as he ambled over, Yerek tried to put himself in the rebels' minds. How would he try to get Anya out of the Empire? Certainly none of the obvious methods would work. Not now that the security service had caught their scent. Near the edge of the clearing were four separate tracks leading west. They were too close together to be car tracks, so that meant ATVs of some sort. Shit! They'd never catch up on foot, and the agency didn't have anything usable of their own, at least not within a day's travel, and by the time something arrived, it would be too late. They'd have to circle around and hope to pick the rebels up on the far side of the forest.
"Agent Yerek?"
Ermina strode up, a harsh frown creasing her pale features.
"What's the problem?"
"Our targets have acquired transportation. No way we can keep up on foot."
"Perhaps you can't."
She chanted in one of the wizard's nonsense languages, and when she stopped, she floated a foot off the ground.
but I can.
She turned east.
Wait!
Irmina glared at him.
Do you have a phone or radio or something we can use to keep in touch?
A white witch has no need of such mundane things.
No, of course they didn't. However, Yerek didn't want to end up with another dead witch on his hands. It would look bad on his record. Not to mention his boss might have him shot.
Igor!
Yerek said. A stout 22-year-old agent in a stained gray suit huffed and puffed his way over.
Sir? Mistress Irmina needs to borrow your phone. Be a good lad and dig it out.
Igor pulled a blocky little flip phone from his inner pocket and held it toward the witch, like he feared she might take his hand along with the phone. Irmina glared at both of them, and for a minute he feared she might refuse. Finally, she snatched the phone out of Igor's hand.
Igor sighed in relief. I will contact you when I've captured them.
Irmina tucked the phone into her white robes and flew away after the tracks. Yerek waited until she was out of sight, then groaned. This was why he hated working with witches. They all wanted to go off and do their own thing. Not a team player in the bunch.
Round up the boys, Igor. We're going back to the cars.
Do you think she'll be able to capture the whole group on her own?
Igor asked.
No. I suspect she'll kill most of them and capture the leaders. Hopefully near an access road. I don't know about you, but I've had enough hiking for one day.
Igor broke into a smile, revealing a broken front tooth.
I'm with you there, sir.
He saluted and went to collect the rest of the team. Yerek sighed. It was important to keep up the boys' morale. Having a witch around wore them out. Now all he needed was someone to lift his morale, and he'd be all set. Anya wasn't sure if it was the steady vibration of the engine, the noxious fumes coming out of the exhaust, or the fact that she didn't sleep worth a damn the night before, but she found herself half dozing off as they roared through the forest. She blinked and yawned, trying to shake it off. Their little group had left the shack 3 hours ago, and were now in the middle of God knew where.
Witch!
The shouted warning came from one of the other buggies. A burst of adrenaline washed away her weariness in an instant. She twisted around, but saw nothing. Where was she? A blast of lightning sent dirt flying between Anya's buggy and the one to her right. She tried to track where the attack had come from. For an instant, she thought she saw a ghost of white flitting between the trunks, but it vanished before she could say for sure. Two of the buggies skidded to a stop. The rebels on board scrambled out and drew their weapons.
What are they doing?
Anya shouted as Fyodor hit the accelerator. Seven people with guns were no match for a white witch.
Buying us time.
Another crack shattered the air, and a pine tree came crashing down in front of them. Fyodor barely slammed on the brakes in time to avoid crashing into the trunk. The pine tree had to be a foot and a half in diameter, and it blocked the whole road. It seemed the witch didn't intend to let them escape. The shifting lever clunked into reverse, and Fyodor backed up to join those who'd remained behind. A man in black carrying an old bolt-action rifle ran over.
What are you doing? We have to use it,
Fyodor said.
She blocked the road. If we use it now, we'll be defenseless, and it's a long way to the border.
Anya didn't know what they planned to use, but they'd better do it fast. A flutter of white drew her attention to the sky. The witch descended and hovered a few feet from the gathered rebels.
Surrender now, and your deaths will be quick, she said.
The woman from the cook fire raised her pistol and fired. A gust of wind roared and blew the bullet aside. As if it was a signal, all the rebels opened fire. What looked like a tornado sprang up around the witch. When the guns fell silent, the winds died, revealing their unharmed opponent. The witch favored them with a sneer of contempt.
Pathetic.
She gestured, and the winds grabbed the woman that fired first, lifted her up, and slammed her into a roadside tree 20 feet up. She hung there, impaled by three branches. The witch watched her bleed, a little smile on her cruel face. Fyodor pulled a black crystal the size of a hen's egg out of his pocket. The man that had objected earlier nodded. Fyodor drew back and hurled the crystal at the witch. The wind flared up again, but the crystal punched through it. The witch's eyes widened a moment before the gem crashed into her chest. It shattered. Magic flared, forcing Anya to look away. When she looked back, a 7-foot-tall black crystal floated where the witch had been a moment before. Yerik was 3 hours into a 5-hour cross-country trip and enjoying his time away from the witch when his phone rang. Who could that be? The guys in the car behind couldn't need anything, and he wasn't expecting to hear from anyone at headquarters. He grimaced and groped through his pockets for 3 rings before finally getting a grip on his little phone. It would have been nice if the cheap piece of junk had caller ID, but since the government provided it, he only had the most basic features. He flipped it open.
Yerik,
I require your presence at once,
Ermina said. Yerik held the phone away from his ear and stared at it as though it had betrayed him.
I'm on the road. We should reach the far side of the forest in 2 hours. Where are you?
In the forest. I'm not exactly sure where. The rebels had a magical artifact. They used it to trap me and escape.
Yerik smothered a laugh. If she heard him, he'd be dead the instant they met up.
Okay. We should be able to track your cell phone signal, so be sure not to turn it off. We'll be there as soon as we can.
Hurry, agent. While you dawdle, the enemy escapes.
The line went dead, and he tossed the phone into the passenger seat. Arrogant bitch. Blaming him for the target's escape when she was the one they captured. Probably got overconfident and let them get the drop on her. Served her right. Maybe she'd be more careful next time. Yerik grabbed his radio mic.
Guys, pull over a second. Igor, we have the cell phone tracker, right?
If they didn't, he'd have to go to the local base at Dorcha and borrow one. That would take an extra couple hours, which would do nothing to improve the witch's mood. The radio crackled, and Igor said,
Yes, sir. In the trunk. Why?
Yerik pulled off the side of the road and switched on his hazard lights.
Just get it out. We need to find Ermina.
Igor pulled in behind him, and everyone got out. From the trunk, Igor removed a box with a handheld antenna. He flipped the power switch, punched in a series of numbers, and spun in a slow circle. Yerik didn't know how his subordinate managed so well with technology, but he had the knack. When he paused, Igor faced the forest, and a little bit back the way they'd come.
That way, maybe 40 or 50 miles.
Yerik stared at the sprawling expanse of evergreens. How in the world would he reach her through all that? There had to be logging roads. That was what the resistance was using to move around. If she confronted them, it had to be on or near one of the roads. He frowned at his pitiful car. No way could he take that through the woods. Yerik tapped his chin and tried to think.
Are there any logging operations in the area?
Yerik asked. All he got in answer were blank stares. Why should he be surprised? It wasn't security agency business, so his men would have no reason to know about it. Yerik retrieved his phone and dialed base.
Rostov, I need you to check the county records and find me the nearest logging operation.
Should I ask why you want to find loggers when you're supposed to be looking for rebels?
No.
Hold on.
Yerik barely heard the clicking of Rostov's keyboard.
Okay, I've got 3 registered jobs. Where are you?
80 miles east of Dorcha on 7E.
Ugh, you're 30 miles from the nearest location.
Rostov rattled off a series of directions.
Did you get all that?
More or less. If I get lost, I'll call again.
Yedek hung up.
Load up, boys. We're going hunting.
Anya had never been to Dorcha before. The caravan of dune buggies stopped at the edge of the forest on a hill overlooking the city. Even from a distance, it looked grungy and rough. Smokestacks chugged black smoke into the air, which mingled with the exhaust from the train depot to stain the whole city gray. Like everything else in the Empire, the squatty buildings were constructed of cinder blocks and concrete with metal roofs. If there existed a more dingy place in the world, she couldn't imagine it. Anya, her mother, and Fyodor got out of their buggy, and one of the remaining rebels climbed behind the wheel. Fyodor exchanged a few quiet words, and the group took off. Anya watched them until they were out of sight. Her chest felt tight, and her breath came in ragged gasps. They were on their own again. Somehow, having a larger group felt safer. Though after the encounter with the witch, she realized the stupidity of that idea. Fyodor checked his watch.
We need to get going. Our train is supposed to leave in 3 hours.
What about the others?
Anya asked.
Will they be okay?
Fyodor stared down a narrow path toward the city.
I hope so. Their job now is to lay a false trail that will hopefully buy us the time we need.
Anya and her mother fell in behind him.
What was that thing you used to stop the witch?
A gift from one of our allies. If all goes according to plan, you'll meet Lord Dallan in 3 weeks.
But what was it?
I have no idea. He said if I ever found myself in an encounter with a witch with no hope of escaping, to throw it at her.
Not the most detailed instructions,
Mom said. Fyodor barked a laugh.
No, but it worked, and that's what matters.
The path brought them to a wheat field. The golden stalks came up to Anya's chest. The field spread as far as she could see in either direction. At the far end, a road waited to take them into the city.
Won't we have to go through a checkpoint?
Anya asked.
Yes, a very specific one. We have a friend waiting. Keep low.
Fyodor crouched down and set out through the grain. Mom motioned her to go first, so she bent low and followed Fyodor's tracks. For a time, her world became a golden forest of tiny stalks. A small part of her, the part that wanted to pretend she was still a regular girl, and all she had to worry about was taking the career placement exam, tried to pretend this was all a game of hide-and-seek. And it was, except the people doing the seeking wanted to kill them. Half an hour later, they stopped at the edge of the field. Cars and trucks whizzed by on the nearby road. There wasn't a bit of foot traffic to be seen. When Anya mentioned it, Fyodor said,
Don't worry. Plenty of locals walk into town. There's a footpath half a mile to the south that leads to our inside man's post. You know, we've been planning this for years. Have a little faith.
Anya had plenty of fear, anxiety, and anger, but she was low on faith. Maybe if they made it to the train without any witches appearing, she'd dredge some up. Once more, Fyodor led the way, this time skirting the road and hurrying along at the edge of the field. Just as he'd said, they reached the end of the field and found a footpath that ran parallel to the street. They stepped out and started toward the city. Anya clenched her bag tighter as they approached one of the innumerable guard shacks that dotted the country. She'd heard you couldn't travel more than 100 miles in any direction without running into one. Ahead of them, a man and woman reached the shack. 3 men in white uniforms emerged, and a brief conversation ensued. Documents were examined, and they were allowed in. Nothing to it. as long as you weren't a wanted woman. Fyodor slowed his pace to a crawl.
What's wrong?
Mom asked.
There were only supposed to be two guards, a friend and a lazy sergeant that made him do all the work.
What does that mean for us?
Her mother asked. Anya wondered the same thing, but couldn't force the words through her clenched teeth.
I don't know.
Fyodor's doubt sent a shudder through her. This was it. They were going to die before even escaping the county.
We'll just have to go through with it, and hope our friend has a plan.
Hope someone they'd never met could solve their problem for them. That was the plan? It took every ounce of courage she could muster to keep putting one foot in front of the other. What choice did she have? It wasn't like she had anywhere to run. When they were 300 yards away, Fyodor said,
Remember, we're just regular folks visiting family in the city. Don't do anything to make them more suspicious than they already are. Take your new documents out now so you'll be ready.
Anya dug the little booklet out of her pocket and forced herself not to squeeze it too tight. She didn't want to tear the stupid thing. Another person, a woman on her own, went through the checkpoint. Then it was their turn. Anya took a deep breath and forced herself to relax. Her nerves would be more likely to get them caught than anything.
Bebers.
She looked up at the gaunt face of a middle-aged officer wearing a crisp white uniform. He held out a gloved hand, and Fyodor put his false documents into it. The guard pursed thin, bloodless lips as he studied the forgery. Beside him, a fat slob in a stained uniform watched the proceeding with supreme disinterest. A third, younger man stood behind his superiors, his gaze darting from the head guard to Fyodor and back again. He had to be the inside man. He didn't look like the sort of person you'd want to rely on to get you out of trouble. The poor guy looked as nervous as Anya felt. Finally, the guard handed Fyodor his papers and turned to Mom. She handed him her booklet and even smiled. Anya doubted she'd have had it in her. Her mother was tougher than she'd thought. The guard gave Mom her papers and turned his cold blue eyes on Anya. He held out his hand a third time, and she handed her ever so slightly trembling booklet to him. He snatched it and started reading. After a heart-stopping minute, he handed them back.
Everything appears in order, he said.
Her heart soared. They'd done it. The fake documents had gotten them through.
There's just one more thing.
He reached into the shack and emerged with a testing stick like the witch brought to their house. He offered it to Anya.
All girls appearing to be between the ages of 15 and 20 must be tested. There's a missing wizard candidate, you see, and we can't take any chances.
She reached for it, knowing exactly what was going to happen. They were doomed. She'd been stupid to think they could escape. The Empire was too vast and powerful. Her fingers brushed the wood, and the first gem lit up. The guard's lip curled in a vicious smile.
Miss Kazakov, we've been looking everywhere for you. The Tsar is eager to make your acquaintance.
Yurik swore to himself that he'd never complain about the roads being rough again. Their commandeered skitter, a rusty beast of a machine with tires taller than Yurik and designed to drag logs out of the woods, bounced along the 4-foot-deep ruts, jarring his insides and reminding him once more why he hated witches. At least the sun was out, and the fresh-cut pine smelled nice. The little of it that reached him over the diesel exhaust anyway. To say that the loggers hadn't been thrilled when a group of security agents rolled up on their job site and demanded a ride into the woods would have been understating things by a fair bit. The five rugged men might have been annoyed, but they weren't stupid. Beyond a few grumbles, they quickly complied with his orders. Seated on the opposite fender, Igor had his eyes locked on the screen of his tracking device. Yarek had ordered the rest of the team to remain with the cars. He doubted Irmina would appreciate having every man under his command watching her rescue. They came to an intersection of roads, and Igor pointed left. The huge machine lurched, forcing Yarek to tighten his grip.
"We're close!"
Igor shouted over the roar of the engine. They rumbled along for another minute.
"A quarter mile!"
Yarek tapped the operator on the shoulder and drew his finger across his throat. The driver shifted into neutral and switched the machine off.
"Wait here,"
Yarek said.
"We'll be back soon."
The logger shrugged.
"If I don't make my quota this week, I'm blaming you. You think that'll help?"
His comment brought a humorless laugh.
"I don't expect it would."
Yarek patted his shoulder.
"Don't worry. I'll leave a requisition letter for half a day's work. As long as you're not off by more than that, you'll be fine."
The logger raised an eyebrow.
"That's decent of you."
He didn't add,
"For a government agent."
But Yarek heard it all the same. He wasn't surprised. Most of his comrades in the security forces enjoyed using their authority to force others to do what they wanted, even as they resented their own superiors doing it to them. Petty tyrants and bullies. Every son of a bitch in the government. Yarek despised most of them. But he had to put food on the table, so he kept his mouth shut and did his job. He slid to the ground, grateful to be off his uncomfortable seat. After a couple awkward steps, he joined Igor in front of the skitter.
"Lead on."
Yarek motioned his second ahead of him. Igor shuffled along. His gaze darted between the tracker and the rough ground. It was slow going, but when they rounded a clump of short evergreens, they found a 7-foot-tall black crystal floating a foot off the ground. Yarek rubbed his eyes. Had he breathed in too many fumes?
"You see that thing too, right?"
Igor nodded, his mouth partway open. Yarek dug out his phone and dialed. She answered it on the first ring.
"What's taking you so long?"
"We're here,"
Yarek said.
"How do I get you out?"
"The crystal is only immune to magic. Hit it with something heavy and it'll shatter."
"Understood."
He hung up and looked around for a good-sized rock. It didn't take long to find one that fit in his hand.
"Move away a little just in case."
He didn't have to tell Igor twice. His subordinate scrambled back 100 feet. Yarek cocked his arm and slammed the rock into the crystal. A spiderweb of cracks ran through it. One more ought to do it. He drew back and gave it another rap. The trap fell apart, but instead of pieces of crystal falling to the ground, they dissolved and vanished into the air. Irmina landed on the ground and stumbled. Yarek reached out without thinking and steadied her. The witch glared and yanked her arm out of his grasp. Typical.
"Are you well?"
he asked.
"Fine. The magic doesn't prevent air from entering. Lucky for me, considering how long it took you to get me out."
Yarek choked on several retorts.
"Sorry. We should get to Dorcha as soon as possible."
"I'll be there in half an hour. Join me as soon as you can."
The witch chanted and streaked up into the air. Yarek watched until she was just a speck in the sky.
"You're welcome."
4. Race to the train station. Anya couldn't stop staring at the guard's gaunt face. It had never occurred to her that they might have a testing device. She'd assumed only witches carried them. A sharp chuff sounded, and something wet splattered her face. The guard collapsed as a red stain spread across his fine uniform. A second chuff, and the fat guard collapsed, revealing the young man holding a small pistol with a long cylinder attached to the barrel. Fyodor grabbed the pistol and punched the spy in the face. He went down in a heap among the corpses.
"Quickly,"
he said.
"Someone will surely report the shots."
He grabbed the still stunned Anya and hustled her through the gate and into the city. Her mother brought up the rear. She seemed awfully calm, considering they'd just witnessed two men get murdered. Anya barely registered the drab buildings as they hurried along. Mom stayed on one side of her, and Fyodor the other, shielding her from the other pedestrians' view. She tried to think, but her mind refused to obey. A minute or two later, they entered a low building. The smell of cooking food turned her stomach, and it took all her will not to throw up. Mom gently grasped her by the arm and guided her into a nearby bathroom. She led Anya to the sink and turned the water on. While it heated up, Mom went to the towel dispenser. Anya stared at herself in the mirror. Blood covered her face and dress. She looked like a madwoman from a horror movie. Her hands shook so bad when she reached up to wipe the blood away, she feared she might poke her eyes out. Mom returned, towels in hand, and washed her face like she'd done when Anya was still a little girl.
"We're safe now, Kiska,"
Mom spoke in a soft, reassuring voice.
"Let's get you cleaned up."
When her face and hands were clean, Anya stripped off the blood-stained dress and slipped into her spare, a loose, pale blue sundress. She liked to wear it during the far too brief summers.
"There,"
Mom said.
"Don't you look pretty? Do you feel better?"
"I just saw two people killed before my eyes. We burned our house down, and now we're racing to a future I can't imagine in a country I've only read about in books. So no, I am far, far away from better."
"I'm sorry this happened to you, Kiska. Sometimes in life, we just get dealt a bad hand. But I promise, life will be better in the Kingdom of the Isles than it ever could be here. We'll be free. There'll be no checkpoints, no security agents, and best of all, no light witches. You'll have the chance to use your gift as you want to use it, or do not use it at all. The important thing is that it will be up to you."
Anya tried to imagine the life her mother described, but it wouldn't come. The ideas were too foreign. She took a deep breath to steady herself.
"So what now?"
"Fyodor is speaking to our contacts upstairs. Assuming everything is ready, we'll head for the train depot to catch a ride out of here."
"Won't the security people on the train spot us?"
Mom looked away.
"We're not traveling by passenger train."
Anya frowned.
"How then?"
"I believe our car is carrying furniture. At least, we'll have somewhere to sit."
"Great. I guess it could be worse."
An image of the dead men popped into her head. Yes, it could certainly be worse. Fyodor watched a moment as Sasha led her trembling, blood-soaked daughter toward the bathroom. He doubted anyone could see the mess in the dark bar, which was just as well. Not that anyone here would say anything. The Black Hammer Bar and Grill was a rebel hangout, and Imperials got a cold welcome and quick kick in the ass back out. He sighed as the ladies disappeared into the bathroom. Anya was a strong girl, stronger than he had any reason to hope for. Though shaken, she hadn't frozen up. Thank God for that. If she'd started screaming or fainted, they'd have been in real trouble. With a final shake of his head, Fyodor made his way toward the bar. A young woman with six studs in her nose leaned over and smiled at him.
"What can I get you?"
a fizzy dragon.
Her smile vanished as quickly as it appeared.
Behind the bar, up the stairs, first door on your right.
Fyodor nodded and hopped over the bar. A narrow door led to the kitchen, where three people in white chef's coats were busy cooking at a long grill. They never so much as glanced his way, so Fyodor ignored them and climbed the spiral staircase to his left. It was a narrow fit for a man his size, but he made it up to the second floor. He turned right and rapped on the closed door.
Come in.
Fyodor pushed the door open and stepped inside, a simple office filled with papers, binders, a copy machine that looked like it came from the Elf War, and a desk with a slim man in a dark suit behind it. The man rose and held out his hand.
Fyodor, you're a little behind schedule.
Fyodor took the fine-boned hand in his blunt paw.
We ran into a few difficulties. You're the manager?
Correct. Tell me everything.
Fyodor did as he asked, and when he finished, the manager said,
running into a witch so early was unfortunate, but you handled matters well. I'm confident we made the right choice in agreeing to let you escort the young lady on her journey.
Thank you, sir.
A general alert has gone out to all security forces along with your descriptions. That was expected and shouldn't be a problem. Our spy says three witches have been assigned to the search. Avoiding them is our biggest priority.
When do we move?
Immediately. I've arranged transport to the train station. The truck will arrive in 5 minutes. Don't worry about the guard. I'm sure young Garrus will be fine. That boy's been a fine undercover asset. He's quick on his feet and knows when to keep his mouth shut.
The manager came around the desk and went over to the right-hand wall. He tapped twice, and a secret panel opened. From within, he pulled a worn duffel bag.
Everything you'll need for the train ride, you'll find inside.
Fyodor took the bag and unzipped it. It wasn't that he didn't trust the manager, but he liked to know what he had to work with. Inside were ration packs, two automatic pistols and ammunition, a change of clothes for each of them, and a first aid kit. Minimal. But as long as they didn't run into any major issues, it should suffice. He zipped the bag up.
If there's nothing else, sir, I should collect Sasha and Anya.
No, there's nothing more I can do for you. I'll call the truck and have them meet you at the loading dock. Good luck.
Thank you, sir.
Fyodor turned and left the office. The manager had done all he could. It was up to them now. The late afternoon sun hung low in the sky when Yerik finally reached Dorcha. The limited light hid some of the dingy grayness of the city, but it didn't help much. Did the Imperial designers lay out the cities like this in the hope of depressing the populace so they wouldn't think of joining the rebellion? Probably not, since the cities predated the rebels by centuries. Yerik sighed. He'd planned to arrive for lunch and be home for a late dinner, but thanks to the witch, it looked like he'd be spending the night. As he approached the eastern checkpoint, Yerik frowned. A large group of white-clad security officers had gathered around the guard shack that serviced the pedestrian entrance. What in the world could have happened to warrant that many officers? His turn came. He rolled down his window and pulled out his identification. One look, and the gate guard saluted and raised the bar for him. Before Yerik pulled through, he asked,
"What happened next door?"
"Horrible thing, sir. A rebel attack. Two guards were murdered and a third injured. They're trying to get things sorted out now."
"Did a white witch named Ermina come through here?"
The guard chuckled.
"The witches don't come through the gates, sir. They fly straight to the dragon temple in the city center."
Yerik nodded.
"Thanks."
The guard blinked in astonishment. Yarek drove through and immediately hooked a left over to the foot entrance. He found a parking place 100 yards up the street and got out. Igor and the boys joined him a moment later.
What's happening, sir?
Igor asked.
Resistance activity. If there's any chance it has something to do with our targets, we need to check it out.
What about the witch?
Yarek shrugged. Irmina was doing her own thing, the way witches always did. He couldn't worry about her if he wanted to catch his missing family.
She's probably at the Dragon Temple. If you want to go check in with her, I don't mind.
No, sir, Igor said. We'll stick with you.
That drew quick nods of agreement from the junior agents, just as Yarek knew it would. He doubted they'd even let a junior agent into the temple. They'd probably just turn them into rats and feed them to the cats that hung out all over the place. He smiled to himself at the idea of Igor as a rat and strolled over to the scene. Yarek had his ID out as he approached, and a city officer waved him through. One good thing about being an Imperial security agent was that his authority extended to every corner of the empire, and he outranked all but the highest city officials. Yarek spotted an officer with a gold badge on his chest, marking him as the highest-ranking individual present. He walked over, and when the officer noticed him, asked,
What happened? Who are you? And who let you into my crime scene?
The officer asked.
Senior security agent Yarek Barodanov. That young man back there let me through.
The officer's Adam's apple worked as he tried to swallow.
I'm terribly sorry, agent. It's this horrible situation. It's got me on edge. Perfectly understandable.
You were saying?
Yes, sir. It appears one or more resistance fighters attacked the checkpoint and broke through into the city. I have men trying to locate them now, but I fear they'll simply blend into the populace. The bastards have a knack for it. Indeed. So you have no description and no real idea of numbers, is that correct?
The officer blanched.
I'm afraid so, sir. Our only survivor was attacked from behind and rendered unconscious before his comrades were killed. To take three of our guards so completely by surprise, I assume more than one assailant was involved. A reasonable assumption. Where is your survivor? I'd like to speak with him and offer a commendation for his survival.
That brightened the gloomy fellow's expression. Commendations for a subordinate made the commander look good, too.
Right this way, sir.
Yarek followed his guide off to the right, out of sight of the crime scene. Seated on a stretcher was a young man in his mid-20s with sandy hair and a very broken nose. He held his head in both hands, the very image of a soldier grieving his fallen comrades.
Guard Karis, on your feet,
the officer said. Karis's head snapped up, and he winced before lurching halfway off the stretcher.
That's all right, son. No need to stand on protocol after all you've been through. Just relax.
Karis slumped down, and the officer, Yarek really should ask the man his name, but he just couldn't muster the interest, stared at him like he'd grown a second head.
Thank you, sir. It's been a hell of a day.
The exhaustion was honest enough. No one was that good an actor.
I just have a few questions, then we'll get you to the infirmary.
Yes, sir,
Karis said.
Though I don't know what I can tell you that I haven't told everyone else. That's fine. I prefer to hear the story directly from the source. Old-fashioned that way, I guess. Just start from the beginning. We were between arrivals, and the three of us were standing outside the guardhouse. I was closest to the city gate, behind my sergeant and the lieutenant,
As a family approached on foot, someone struck me from behind. And I fell flat on my face, breaking my nose. Or so the medics tell me. I can't remember anything after the first blow.
Yerrick gave an encouraging nod. Maybe it happened that way. But he'd seen plenty of broken noses over the years, and that one looked like a fist made it. Despite the expression, people seldom fell flat on their face.
And the approaching family, what did they look like?
A husband and wife, I assumed, along with their daughter. The women had dark hair and light dresses. The husband sported a thick salt and pepper beard and thin clothes. They looked like ordinary people to me.
Yerrick nodded.
I don't suppose you know what became of them. They might have information about your attackers.
Sorry, sir. I didn't see where they went.
Yerrick clapped him on the back.
That's quite all right, son. Get yourself checked out.
He left the guard and walked toward his car. Something about this felt wrong, but he couldn't put his finger on what.
Is everything all right, Agent?
The officer had tagged along with him as he walked.
I'm not certain. Assign someone to keep an eye on our survivor, discreetly. I want to know where he goes and who he talks to. Maybe it's my overactive imagination, but better safe than sorry. I'll see to it personally,
the officer said.
Excellent.
Yerrick rattled off his cell phone number.
If anything interesting comes up, you can reach me at that number.
Yerrick left the officer writing on the back of his hand and slid behind the wheel of his car. He needed to find the witch. He had to assume their quarry had entered the city. Anya had herself reasonably under control when someone knocked on the bathroom door. When Mom opened it, they found Fyodor waiting with a bag slung over his shoulder.
You two ready? We've only got half an hour to meet our ride.
We're coming.
Mom stuffed the bloody dress in Anya's almost empty bag and handed it to her.
It'll be okay.
Anya nodded, and they left the bathroom. Fyodor stood a few feet away. She couldn't guess what was in the large canvas duffel bag slung over his shoulder. But the way things had been going, it was probably filled with machine guns and hand grenades.
What news?
Mom asked.
The city's buzzing with security officers.
And at least three white witches.
They have our descriptions, but there are a lot of blonde girls and men with beards in the city, so that'll slow them down some. The truck's waiting out by the rear loading dock.
They followed Fyodor past a few empty tables and through a swinging door that led to a kitchen. Now that she'd collected herself, the food didn't smell so bad, and she realized she hadn't eaten since the biscuit that morning.
Can we grab a snack?
Anya asked.
No time,
Fyodor said.
I have plenty of provisions. When we're away from the city, we can eat.
Fyodor pushed through another set of doors, and they stepped out onto a loading dock. An unmarked panel truck had backed up to the dock, its rear door open. The interior held dozens of pieces of furniture. Up against the wall was a large, dark trunk. Fyodor opened the lid and motioned her over.
This one's for you.
Anya stood rooted in place.
You want me to hide in there?
Don't worry,
Fyodor said.
It has a false bottom. Even if the security agents search it, they won't see you. Come on.
Mom nudged her, and Anya hurried over. The inside looked awfully dark. Fyodor reached in and lifted out the false bottom.
It's only for a little while.
He took her hand, and Anya stepped inside. It was far deeper than it looked on the outside.
Sit down, and I'll put the panel back.
Anya folded her legs underneath her and ducked her head a little. Fyodor put a thin panel of wood on top of her, and everything went black. A vibration ran through the floor. It was oddly soothing, a reminder that she wasn't alone in a black void. Anya hugged herself, chilled despite the warmth of the close interior. When that guard had looked at her with those cold eyes, she'd known they were doomed. When the rebel killed him, there was a moment, just a moment of relief. She had her freedom, at least for a little while longer. It only cost the lives of two men. Was her freedom worth it? She liked to imagine they were evil men. Certainly the older officer had the look of a villain. It helped a little. If they were just a pair of unlucky pawns working the wrong checkpoint at the wrong time, and they died because she showed up, she wasn't sure how to deal with that. Anya forced the thought to the back of her mind. Better for everyone if she didn't think about it. The Dragon Temple wasn't an actual place of worship. Religion was outlawed in the Empire. The only god here was the Tsar himself. The people called it the Dragon Temple because of the giant dragon statue sitting right between the steps leading up to the doors. Yarik parked, levered himself out of the car, and marched across the sidewalk in front of the building. He looked up at the 10-story white stone building and grimaced. The place had to be crawling with witches. Igor and the boys didn't even bother getting out of their car. Lucky stiffs. He climbed the 10 steps and pushed through the doors. Inside was a reception area that would have been at home in any government building in the Empire. A desk with a middle-aged woman seated behind it rested in the middle of a white-tiled chamber. Her hair was pulled back in a tight bun, and a pair of tiny round glasses perched on the end of her nose. There wasn't another soul in sight, and the silence gave him the creeps. At least he wouldn't have to wait in line. He doubted anyone came here unless compelled. Well, best get on with it. He went over to the desk and plastered a smile on his face. The secretary looked at him without expression.
Yes.
Senior Agent Yarik, to see Ermina.
She's expecting you, I assume?
Yarik nodded.
One moment.
She picked up the phone, hit three numbers, and waited.
There's an Agent Yarik here to see you. As you wish.
She hung up the phone.
She'll be done shortly. Wait by the door, but don't get in the way.
Sure. Wouldn't want to hold up any of your many visitors.
Yarik stood beside the door and ignored the secretary's glare. She wasn't a witch, and he owed her no more than common courtesy. 10 minutes later, a hole opened in the ceiling, and Ermina floated down. She appeared fully composed after her encounter with the rebels. She landed beside him.
Have you found them?
No, but I think they're inside the city.
He told her about the incident at the checkpoint.
It can't be a coincidence.
Agreed. I've sent wind spirits to scour the city. There's some unusual activity at the train yard. Given their obvious desire to escape the Empire, that would be an excellent place to start.
Dorcha served as a transport hub for three connected counties. Hundreds of trains came and went every day, both passenger and cargo. It would take forever to search every one. Lucky they had magic on their side.
Do you have some trick to locate them?
He asked.
I suspect they'll reveal themselves with the proper incentive.
He shivered at the way she said incentive.
On our way, we'll stop at the barracks and call out the reserves. When 300 city guards pour into the yard, they'll have to react. Once we capture a few of them, it won't be difficult to pry loose the knowledge we need.
While he hated working with witches, Yarik was glad to be on the same side as Ermina, at least for the moment. Yarik coughed as they approached the rail yard. The diesel exhaust from hundreds of train engines put a thick haze in the air. It was a wonder the workers didn't all suffer from lung diseases. Ahead of him, three columns of 50 guardsmen each marched in lockstep, their rifles slung over their shoulders. Though their heavy tread was loud, the noise from the trains dwarfed it by several orders of magnitude. He wished he'd thought to bring earplugs. So far, no one had done anything aggressive. In fact, everyone that had seen them ran in the opposite direction. An entirely prudent decision, even for those guilty of nothing beyond having bad luck. Ermina had brought along a pair of her sister witches, and the three of them flew in the air overhead, probably busy searching with magic. Yedek hadn't the slightest idea how that worked, and was just as happy to have them in the air out of his way. The column came to a stop at the central junction where 10 lines came together, and a complex system of switches sent the trains to their proper destinations.
All right,
Yedek had to shout so the men could hear him over the trains.
You all know what the targets look like. Fan out and find them. Remember, we want the girl alive. The rest, well, use your own judgment.
The guards spread out in squads and quickly disappeared amidst the boxcars. Igor and the boys stayed with Yerik.
Should we help, sir?
Igor asked.
No. We brought the guards to handle the grunt work. We'll stay here and coordinate. By coordinate, you mean we'll wait until they catch the target, then swoop in and snatch her, right?
Igor asked.
Not at all.
Yerik grinned.
I'm sure Ermina and her friends will grab the girl long before we arrive. We're going to listen for gunfire and explosions. Should we hear any, we'll contact the teams and send them in the proper direction. I certainly have no intention of getting shot in this filthy excuse for a city. Amen to that, sir,
Igor said. Barely 10 minutes had passed when the first explosion sounded. It wasn't an especially big one, probably a hand grenade. It came from Yerik's left. He squinted through the haze, but saw nothing but more haze. He raised his radio.
Possible encounter in quadrant 3. Squads 13 and 14 converge.
A pair of beeps acknowledged his order. Less than a minute later, the clatter of gunfire came from that direction. He hadn't expected much in the way of resistance. Either the rebels were desperate, overly eager to get the girl out, or simply couldn't pass up so many targets. Yedek suspected option 3. A couple hundred targets and no civilians to get in the way? It was too perfect. A train chugged by, and one of the automatic switches clanged over.
I thought we shut those down,
Yedek said. A second train rolled out. If the trains dispersed, they'd never track down the girl.
We did shut it down,
Igor said.
But they're all computer controlled. A simple command could get them moving again, no problem. Didn't we leave guards in the control room?
Igor nodded.
6 of them?
A gust of wind pelted Yerik with gravel. A moment later, a screaming man went flying into the sky. Looked like the witches had gotten into the scrum.
Let's check out the control room.
Yerik drew his pistol and led the way. More trains set out by the second. Everywhere Yerik looked, he found movement. It would be hard to separate a real threat from a shifting shadow. This was why he joined the security services instead of the army. Close quarters combat with a desperate enemy was a good way to get yourself killed. The control room sat at the top of a tower overlooking the yard. By some act of good fortune, they reached the base of it without getting shot at. From the sounds coming from deeper in the yard, the guards weren't so lucky. A door built into the tower swung back and forth in the witch's wind. He grabbed the handle and looked closer. Someone had smashed the lock. He glanced at Igor and found his second had drawn his automatic, as had the boys behind him. Yerik cocked the hammer on his revolver, met the anxious gazes of each of his subordinates, and nodded. He shoved the door open and lunged through. Inside was an empty room, with an iron staircase leading up to the control room. A pair of bodies, their white uniforms stained red, lay at the base of the steps. That answered one of his questions. The step squeaked when he put his weight on it. Yedek grimaced and shifted so his foot was as close to the wall as he could put it. He tried again and was rewarded with silence. One painful step at a time, he worked his way up. The first landing was empty, as was the second. At the top of the third set of steps, a closed door waited. He listened hard, but heard nothing beyond the muted sounds of battle outside. Well, he couldn't hold off any longer. Yedek pointed at Igor, then at the door. His second frowned, but moved ahead of him. The boys went up next, and Yedek brought up the rear. Not the bravest move, but he had a wife to think about. Besides, his younger subordinates had quicker reflexes. Igor tiptoed up to the closest door and tried the handle. He shook his head. Terrific. It was locked. An idea popped into his head. Before he could think too hard about it, Yedek stomped up the steps and knocked. An annoyed voice said,
"What? The Kazakovs are safely away," Yedek said. "We need to withdraw. That wasn't the plan."
The door opened, and Yedek shot a youngster with a thin beard right between the eyes. They charged through. Yedek shot a man raising his machine gun. Beside him, Igor fired as fast as his finger could work the trigger, and the boys did too. When they'd emptied their weapons, the control room was silent. Bodies decorated the floor and control panel. Blood spattered everything. Yedek grimaced. What a mess.
"Stop those trains, Igor."
Igor dragged one of the bodies off the controls.
"No can do, sir." "Why not?" "Rebels locked everything on automatic, then smashed the override controls. It was done before we got here." "So this was nothing but a waste of time."
Yedek holstered his gun.
"We did kill some rebels, sir."
Yedek appreciated Igor's attempt to make him feel better, but a handful of dead rebels wasn't going to help them complete their mission.
"Can you at least access the computer and get a printout of where every train is bound?" "No problem. I can even sort them for you if you'd like." "Put everything headed west at the top. If they're trying to escape the Empire, that's the way they'll be going."
When the lid on her secret compartment went up, the light almost blinded Anya. She'd been lying there, trembling in fear, ever since she heard the first explosion. When her vision came back into focus, she found Fyodor and her mother looking down at her. Her mind finally cleared enough that she noticed the vibration in the floor and rumble of wheels on the track. Fyodor reached down and helped her out. Anya's legs wobbled after so long cooped up in the small space. She stepped out of the trunk and took a few steps. Everything still seemed to work.
"What happened? When I heard those explosions, I feared the worst."
"The security forces figured out how we planned to escape,"
Fyodor said.
"Fortunately, the manager assumed they would and made the necessary preparations. We should be okay for a while. You may as well get comfortable. It's a long ride to Anapa."
The boxcar they'd stowed away on was filled with crates, but there really wasn't anywhere to sit. She paced around, trying to get the blood flowing and settle her nerves. When she stopped, she said,
"They're going to find us again, aren't they?"
Fyodor was a large, dark presence in the shadowy container.
"Probably. Security agents are nothing if not determined. If they do find us, it may come to a fight. Are you up for it?"
Anya restrained a hysterical giggle. She'd never been in a real fight in her life. Her biggest challenges up until this was physics homework and trying to decide whose invitation to the summer dance to accept. Now she found herself on the run from a government that planned to turn her into a slave. She wanted to cry, but refused to indulge her weakness. Maybe she wasn't up to it, but she was damn sure not going down without a fight. Mom started to come to her, but Fyodor held her back.
I don't know,
she said at last.
But I intend to try. Can you teach me to fight?
He chuckled, and she heard his smile.
I certainly can. To shoot too, if you'd like.
Anya nodded to herself.
I'd like that very much.
5. Anapa and the Sea. Yerek tossed the pile of printouts down on his borrowed desk. There were 50 trains headed for various destinations to the west of Dorcha, and any one of them could be carrying the targets. How was he supposed to narrow it down? Hell, they could swap trains at any of a handful of stops along the line. It was like looking for a needle in a haystack. The file on Fyodor wasn't much more useful. Huge chunks of time, sometimes months, were unaccounted for. Yerek wanted to pull his hair out. He stood up, leaned back, and popped his spine into alignment. It felt like he'd been staring at those damn papers forever. All around the Dorcha security building, guards and agents shuffled papers, tapped away at keyboards, and chatted with their comrades while drinking bad coffee. It wasn't so different from home. Yerek hissed through gritted teeth and went to get a cup of the sludge they passed off as coffee. He needed to get this sorted if he wanted to see his wife again before winter. At least Ermina seemed content to spend her time at the temple rather than looming over him. Maybe she'd magic up a solution to their problem. Maybe, but probably not. In his experience, magic had as many limits as it did uses. Not that it didn't have a lot of uses, just not many that applied to investigations of mundane matters. A pair of guards nodded to him as he approached the coffee maker and moved aside to give him room. After 3 days, his mystique as a senior agent had faded, and the men came to realize he was just a guy like them. It was nice that they no longer felt the need to cringe when he looked their way. He took a sip and winced at the bitter, burnt flavor. The pollution in the train yard had left a better taste in his mouth. Maybe he could requisition some used oil from the motor pool. It couldn't help but be an improvement.
Sir!
Igor came hurrying up. The boys had returned yesterday to keep an eye on things back home, so all he had was his second to rely on.
Please tell me you have some good news.
I don't know if it's good, but it's news.
The guard from the checkpoint you wanted watched made contact with a known resistance sympathizer. Though the guard trailing him didn't get close enough to overhear the conversation, he did pinch the sympathizer and bring him in for questioning.
I assume someone is still following the guard?
Yes, sir. The prisoner is in an isolation cell waiting for you. I figured you'd want to handle the questioning yourself.
You figured right. Good job, Igor. Let's go have a chat with our guest.
They left the open work area and made their way to the holding cells. Isolation room 3 held a pimply-faced kid that couldn't have been more than 16. Yerek restrained a groan. He doubted this kid knew his ass from a hole in the ground, much less anything useful.
This is the resistance sympathizer.
Yes, sir.
Igor consulted a file.
He's been arrested twice for painting anti-government graffiti on public buildings.
A graffiti artist. And he's our only lead.
Yerek wanted to bang his head against the wall.
Well, let's see what he has to say.
Igor unbolted the door, and Yerek pushed through. The kid stiffened on his cheap plastic chair. The handcuff connecting him to the bolted-down table jingled when he moved.
So what do you know about the resistance?
Yerek asked.
Nothing, sir, I swear. I haven't tagged a building in months. I'm keeping my nose clean, just like the sergeant told me to.
Then what were you and guard?
Yarek looked at Igor.
What was his name again?
Keres, sir.
Right. What were you and guard Keres talking about just before you were brought in?
The look of confusion on the kid's face almost made Yarek laugh.
Who's guard Keres? The guy you were talking to just before you were brought in. Early 20s, broken nose. Any of this ringing a bell?
You mean Anton? I hardly know the guy. He's dating my sister and wanted me to let her know he couldn't make dinner tonight.
Why didn't he just call?
Yarek asked.
Yana works at the government office, cleaning up or whatever. No cell phones allowed. It's easier for him to tell me, and I'll pass it on since I'll see her tonight when she gets off work.
There was an incident a couple days ago,
Yarek said.
Did Anton mention it?
Yeah, that was fucked up.
The kid shook his head.
He seemed pretty jittery. Is that what all this is about?
Yarek nodded.
We're being extra careful after the killings. Since you were a person of interest to the government, we had to bring you in just to be sure. I'm pleased to see it was nothing, and that you're continuing to behave yourself. Keep up the good work.
Yes, sir.
Igor.
Igor took out his key and unlocked the kid's cuffs before escorting him out of the room. 5 minutes later, they regrouped at Yarek's desk.
So sorry, sir. I thought it was a break.
It might have been. Get me everything you can find on Yana and her brother. A spy in the government offices would be a valuable thing for the resistance, don't you think?
Igor nodded.
I'm on it.
Yarek closed the file Igor had brought him an hour ago on Yana Karova and her brother Myla, the would-be artist. It made for interesting reading. Apparently, their father had been a member of the resistance. When he was caught and executed, the mother hung herself in shame, leaving the children to the tender mercies of a state orphanage. If ever there was an institution capable of churning out a steady stream of rebels, that was it. Yana showed all the precursors of a rebel sympathizer. But unlike her brother, she never acted out. Not once. She got good grades in school, looked after her brother, said and did the right things. She passed the background check for her new job with no troubles. That just went to show how little imagination the government recruiters had. Yarek had no doubt about the rage Yana was hiding. The only question was, how did she let it off? If he had to guess, he'd say by selling information from her job to the rebels. What he needed to determine was whether the guard was a loyal man being used, or if he was in on it. The answer should come tonight after Myla passed news of his questioning onto his sister. If Yarek guessed right, it should be enough to set them off. Hopefully. He pushed away from his borrowed desk and yawned. He had another long night in store. Yana got off work in 5 hours. Maybe he could sneak in a quick nap. Alas, it wasn't to be. He'd barely put his feet up on the desk of a conveniently empty office when a junior guard knocked and poked his head in.
There's a witch here to see you, sir.
He groaned and pushed to his feet. They had the absolute worst timing. He didn't know if it was a magic thing or not, but it felt like a curse to him.
Where is she?
The guard looked over his shoulder.
She's on her way now.
Thanks for the warning. You can make yourself scarce.
Thank you, sir.
The young man hurried off like a frightened rabbit. Not that Yarek blamed him. A few seconds later, the harpy in white appeared in the doorway.
Well, what have you found?
Not a lot, unfortunately. I'm waiting on a lead now. But if it doesn't pan out, we'll be reduced to checking the 50 trains headed west one by one. Is that something your magic can help with?
We've been working on it, but it's difficult to get a fix on moving metal boxes. So much earth interferes with our air magic. She glowered at him. If we had a specific target, it would allow us to focus our energies. He held his hands out in a helpless gesture.
We're doing what we can. With any luck, I'll have something definite for you by tonight. But there are no guarantees.
Ermina swirled her hand and whispered something. Yerrick held his breath and flinched against the coming blow. Instead, a gentle breeze caressed his face.
We can speak freely now.
Yerrick hadn't realized they couldn't speak freely before.
Okay.
News of this debacle has reached His Imperial Majesty the Dragon Czar. I suspect one of my sisters sent a message in an attempt to curry favor. His Majesty is not pleased that one of his future white witches is displaying anything but gratitude for his favor. My orders are to resolve this, and quickly.
Yerrick shook his head. Did she imagine he was taking his time because he enjoyed hanging around in this industrial toilet?
I understand your desire, and would never think to contradict His Majesty's command. However, there are certain aspects of an investigation that can't be rushed. If we push too hard, the resistance in this city will go to ground and will never dig them out until the girl is long gone.
The Dragon Czar, may he rule forever, is not always understanding of the failings of us mere mortals. I say this not as a threat, but simply to make you understand our situation.
If we fail,
banishment to the Eastern Front is the best we can hope for.
Every hint of color had drained from her already pale face. She was scared. Yerrick tried to wrap his mind around that. He'd seen witches angry, arrogant, obsessive, and cruel. But frightened was a new one for him. It made her seem almost human. Vulnerable, even. He didn't know how to handle it. He looked closer at her, the dark, red-rimmed eyes, white hair and sunken cheeks. Her white robe appeared slept in. Underneath all the arrogance and magic, she couldn't be more than 22, young enough to be his daughter. He sighed.
We'll get this sorted out, then return to our boring lives. Don't worry.
She stiffened, and he feared for a moment that he'd shown her too much kindness. But she relaxed again.
Thank you, Agent Yerrick. You contact me when you know something?
It was an honest question, not an order.
I will.
Fyodor held a chair cushion liberated from one of the shipping crates and braced himself. It was more to help with his balance in the shifting boxcar than worry over how hard Anya could punch. He'd been helping her with some basic combat training ever since they left Dorcha, and the girl was an eager pupil. Not terribly skilled, but eager. Anya wiped sweat from her brow and raised her fists again.
Ready?
She asked. Fyodor nodded and forced himself not to smile. He refused to do anything she might interpret as looking down on her. Unlike him, Anya hadn't been a rebel for half her life. Running and fighting and hiding, always in fear for her survival. She'd enjoyed a reasonably normal life, and all this had to be a horrible struggle for her. But she didn't quit, or sulk, and he admired her for that. Her father would be so proud. Her fist slapped into the cushion with more force than last time. She'd begun to figure out how to set her feet to anchor herself before her blow. It was a good start. If he had a year to train her, she'd make a formidable fighter. Unfortunately, he only had another week.
Put more shoulder and hip into it,
Fyodor said after she'd thrown a dozen punches.
Your arm isn't strong enough by itself.
Like this?
She rotated into a good one and knocked him partway off balance.
Better. But you need to throw them all like that.
When can I shoot?
Fyodor grimaced as she resumed pounding the cushion. He'd taught her how to aim with one of the empty pistols, as well as how to properly squeeze the trigger. But they only had 6 clips of ammo, and he hated to waste even a handful of shots, given the danger they might be walking into. On the other hand, if Anya ever needed to use a gun, it would be good for her to have at least felt the recoil of one.
Switch to sidekicks,
Fyodor said.
If you can give me 10 perfect strikes, I'll let you have 3 shots.
She grinned, and Fyodor was struck by just how young she was. Anya should have been thinking about a boyfriend and her career, not running for her life. But if there was one thing he'd learned, it was that life wasn't fair. Anya's 10th kick slammed home. The thought of getting to shoot must have inspired her. Every blow had landed perfectly.
How was that?
Anya asked.
Good.
Fyodor tossed the cushion down and went to the duffel bag. He emerged with a 9mm automatic and a loaded clip. Sasha sat up from her place on a makeshift bed, her lips turned down in a worried frown.
Are you sure this is a good idea?
She needs to learn. If anything happens to us, Anya has to know how to defend herself.
Yeah, Mom. And besides, it'll be fun.
Sasha's frown didn't go away, but she nodded. Fyodor held out the pistol and clip.
Show me how.
Anya took the weapon, slammed the clip into the grip, and worked the action before snapping the safety on. Just like an old pro.
Good.
Fyodor looked around and spotted a slat on one of the crates with a knot in the center. He broke it off and leaned it against a pile of crates. Even if she missed, the bullet would still hit wood instead of going ricocheting around the car.
Take your stance.
Anya stood in front of the board and raised the pistol, gripping with both hands like he'd showed her.
Aim and squeeze.
The crack of the pistol was loud in the car, but her shot was good, an inch to the right of the knot.
Again, make the correction.
Anya nodded and squeezed. The pistol barked, and this time she only missed by a 1/4 inch to the left.
One more.
Anya bit her lip and fired again. The bullet punched the knot out of the board. He didn't know how she'd do if faced with a living, breathing target. But if she found the will, she could at least hit him. The weight of what they'd done to the girl struck him once more. Fyodor swore to himself that he'd do whatever was needed to keep her from having to use a gun again. Yedek shifted, trying to get comfortable on the worn-out seat of his car. He'd parked down the street from the Dorcha government building, a sprawling 3-story complex made of concrete. No one had bothered to paint the building, instead leaving it to weather to a dark gray. If they'd intended to design a building to drain the life out of you, the architect had succeeded beyond his wildest imagination. At least they had a few more hours of sunlight to work with. Tracking the target without getting caught was hard enough without trying to do it at night, especially since the Empire didn't see fit to provide them with night vision goggles. An hour had passed, and Yana's shift ended in 15 minutes. The plan was to follow her home, then see what she did when her brother passed along Kieris's message. If he was right about Yana's sympathies, the reaction should be interesting.
Are you going to call the witch?
Igor slumped in the passenger seat, a pair of binoculars clutched in his hands.
Not until I have something to tell her. We could be barking up the wrong tree here, and I'd just as soon not make myself look any more of a fool than I already have.
Igor looked his way.
You think that's possible, given her history? If there's one thing I'm sure of at this point in my life, it's that anything is possible.
A young man with dark hair ambled down the sidewalk toward the building, his hands thrust into his pockets. Yerrick frowned and squinted. Did he have a bandage on his nose?
Is that Keres?
Iger raised his binoculars.
It sure is. I didn't think he was going to meet her tonight.
Yerrick flipped open his phone and dialed the station. When the front desk answered, he identified himself and said,
"Pitch me through to the surveillance team watching guard Keres."
A moment of static. Then,
"Go ahead, Agent Yerrick. Can you give me an update on the target's position?"
"He went inside about 3 hours ago and hasn't come out."
"It's interesting, because I'm looking at him now. He's loitering outside the government building, no doubt waiting for his girlfriend to emerge."
"That can't be. We've been watching his building nonstop since he went inside."
"Can you see every exit, every window? He slipped past you somehow." "Never mind. Just get over here. If he snuck out, they must have something planned. For God's sake, keep your distance."
Yerrick hung up and dialed Ermina. He suspected they'd need the witch before this night ended.
"There she is, sir,"
Igor said.
"Shit."
Yerrick tried to focus on the ringing phone and the attractive brunette walking toward Keres.
"Agent?"
Ermina said.
"Things are proceeding. Can you join us in the field? We're parked outside the government building."
"I'm on my way."
"Stay in the air and follow my car. We don't want to spook them."
He'd barely finished speaking when he realized he'd just given an order to a white witch. Not good.
"Understood.
I'll wait for your signal to move in."
He let out a breath. She hadn't taken offense. Either that or she was too worried to care. The latter possibility worried him.
"There they go,"
Igor said.
Keres and Yana walked along the street hand in hand, the very picture of a happy couple. Under other circumstances, Yerrick wouldn't have given them a second look. He fired up the car and eased it into gear.
"What's around here?"
Yerrick asked. Igor lowered his binoculars and unfolded a map.
"Not much. Civil service buildings, a few restaurants and businesses. The nearest apartment block is a quarter mile away."
"Anything associated with the resistance?"
"Nothing mentioned in the files I've read."
Igor reached for the radio.
"I can check with headquarters."
Yerrick slapped his wrist.
"You know better. They monitor our frequency. We'll just have to watch them and find out."
He eased the car out of its spot and drove down the road, past the walking couple. They didn't so much as look his way. He continued on, watching them in the rearview mirror. When he'd gone a block, he turned down a side street and stopped.
"Follow them, Igor. Keres knows me, but I bet he didn't notice you."
"Yes, sir. Don't get too close, and if they do anything suspicious, call me."
Igor grinned.
"Don't worry, sir. I can handle a pair of kids."
Yerrick grunted as Igor closed the passenger side door and started up the street. Famous last words. He really hoped Igor didn't do anything stupid. He finally had him trained enough to be of some use. It would be damned inconvenient if he got himself killed. Yerrick's phone rang.
"Yes."
"I'm in position overhead," Ermina said. "I can see your second moving down the street. There's a couple across the way from him. Are they the targets?"
"Yes. I don't expect them to do anything overt on the street. But if you could back up Igor, I'd be grateful."
"Not a problem. Would you like me to leave the line open so I can keep you up to the—"
The line went dead.
"Ermina? Hello?"
Yerrick switched his phone off and on, then dialed her again. Nothing. He tried the surveillance unit and came up empty again. The little readout on his phone read, "No signal." In the middle of the city, he should have perfect reception. The only reason he wouldn't was if someone had messed with the local antenna. God damn it, they'd been spotted. Yerrick slammed the car into reverse and laid a track of smoking rubber down as he screeched out of the side street. Tires squealed as he cranked the wheel and skidded around. A bullet sent cracks running through his windshield. He flinched, slammed it into drive, and stomped the accelerator. A second round punched through his roof. Yerrick crouched down as if it would do any good and groped for the radio.
This is Yerrick. We need backup in the government district now.
What is your location, agent? The dispatcher asked.
I don't know. Just send them towards the gunfire. Now!
He dropped the mic and risked a glance over the dash. The street Igor had gone down was just ahead. He whipped the car around. His second was pinned down behind a dumpster, and Ermina was lying in the middle of the street. More rounds peppered the car as he drove between the witch and the shadowy figures on the rooftops shooting at them. He opened the door and rolled out beside the witch. She was bleeding from a shoulder wound and from her stomach. God, what a mess. He tore his jacket off, jammed it hard against the stomach wound. Ermina moaned, which reassured him that she was still alive.
Hold it tight.
She groaned, but did as he said. Yerrick drew his pistol and popped up for a look. Bullets clattered against the car, forcing him back down. He counted four people for sure. Considering they had rifles and the high ground, that was more than enough.
Igor, you hurt?
I'm fine, sir. They shot the witch first, which gave me enough warning to get down.
I don't suppose you have a shot?
Afraid not.
Yerrick flinched when two more shots pinged off the roof. The rebels seemed content to hold them down. Where the hell was his backup?
Did you see where the targets went?
Sorry, sir, Igor said. I got distracted.
Talk about a bad situation. He needed to get Ermina to a healer. Thunder cracked in the clear night just before a blinding light forced him to shut his eyes. When he opened them again, Yerrick risked a look over the car. Two figures in white flew around the roof where the gunmen had been moments before. Backup at last. Not the kind he'd been expecting, but for once he wasn't about to complain about witches showing up unannounced. Yerrick scrambled to his feet and waved to draw their attention. Yet another thing he never imagined himself doing. The witches held their positions for another few seconds before flying in a tight arc down to the car. Both women looked older than Ermina, though younger than him.
What happened?
The older witch asked.
Ambush. She got hit twice. I've done what I can for the bleeding, but I'm no healer.
The older witch turned a cold eye on her younger companion.
Take care of her.
The younger witch motioned Yerrick out of the way and held her hands over Ermina. A golden bubble of energy surrounded her, and the two of them flew off. Yerrick watched them until they were out of sight.
Will she be all right?
Of course. No white witch would be slain from such minor wounds.
The wounds had looked pretty serious to Yerrick, but he held his peace.
Thank you for the rescue. I expected more conventional backup.
We overheard the call and knew one of our sisters was with you, so we chose to respond. Tell me everything.
Yerrick did as she bid, and when he finished, she said,
How did they know Ermina was there? And what sort of weapon did they use to penetrate her defenses?
I'd very much like the answers to those questions as well. Could I persuade you to lend us your help in tracking down our missing rebels?
A cruel smile twisted her thin lips.
I will question the dead. Then we will hunt down the Tsar's enemies and make them beg for death.
Yerrick swallowed. That was more the sort of attitude he expected from a white witch. He seldom pitied anyone stupid enough to oppose the Empire. But in that moment, he felt bad for Keres and Yana. He wouldn't wish an encounter with this witch on anyone. Even a pair of rebels. Yerik, Igor, and the witch, Nosarova, marched down the street toward a closed-up food distribution center. The modest-sized, single-story building had been shut down, and its inventory moved to a larger warehouse years ago. Like everything else not directly involved with members of the ruling class, it was made of cement blocks with narrow windows. For some reason, the Empire liked to build even the most mundane structure like it had to withstand a bomb blast. Yerik had never understood it. But then his job didn't require him to understand his master's foolishness, only to obey them. The witch had muttered and waved her hands, then marched them down the empty street. The gun battle seemed to have scared off all the locals, a good thing for them, as they didn't have to worry about any innocents getting caught in the crossfire. He wouldn't have to worry anyway. Somehow he doubted Nosarova would be overly concerned about anyone that had the misfortune to get in her way.
"Are you sure this is the place?"
Yerik asked. She shot him a glare.
"Of course. I can sense magic emanating from the building, and it isn't ours."
Yerik tensed up. Regular people like him were sitting ducks if the enemy had magic. If it came to a fight, he doubted he and Igor would be of much help.
"How do you want to handle this? Magic is way outside my area of expertise."
"I will deal with the rebels,"
she said.
"You two stay out here and make sure no one escapes.
If there are multiple exits, we might miss someone,"
Yerik said.
"Maybe we should wait for the second surveillance team to arrive."
"There's no time."
She whistled and gestured. Yerik didn't see anything, but he assumed she'd accomplished something.
"There. I've placed guardians on the other side of the building. You two need only worry about this one. I trust you can handle that much at least."
"You bet.
Good luck."
She sniffed.
"When you have magic, luck is unnecessary."
Nosarova strutted across the street like she hadn't a fear in the world. Surprising, considering Irmina had just been shot by these rebels. Did she think acting fearless would intimidate any watching rebels? Or was she stupid enough to believe Irmina had simply been careless? All he knew for sure was that having two witches get shot while working with him wouldn't be good for his career. Or his life.
"I liked the other one better,"
Igor said. Yerik nodded, but didn't speak. If the witch was using magic to listen in on them, he didn't want to say anything that might set her off. Across the street, Nosarova reached the door and waved her hand. Nothing happened. She made a more complex motion and pointed at the door. A light flashed, but still nothing happened to the door.
"Nosarova seems to be experiencing technical difficulties."
Igor grinned, seeming thoroughly amused by her troubles. Yerik wasn't amused in the least. Anything that gave a white witch problems would probably kill a pair of security agents with no difficulty. Finally, she stomped her foot, looked their way, and waved for them to join her.
"So much for watching the door."
Yerik led the way across the street at a flat-out run, his head on a swivel. They reached the door without encountering any resistance. That was a stroke of good luck.
"Is there a problem?"
he asked.
"Obviously there's a problem."
She jabbed a bony finger at the door as though accusing it of a crime.
"The rebels have acquired a dark magic ward, and it's blocking my magic. You two will have to enter and arrest everyone inside while I keep watch."
"We need to wait for reinforcements,"
Yerik said.
"There's no way to know how many rebels are inside, and if we don't have your magic to back us up, we'll be sitting ducks."
"I told you there isn't time. The longer we wait, the better the chances of them escaping."
No one can escape with your magic surrounding the building. We can have an entry team here in 10 minutes. Please.
Her expression hardened.
Get in there and do your job. Or so help me, I'll have you before the court of corruption on insubordination charges. Goddamn witches.
Yedek drew his revolver.
All right. Igor, put your boot to that door, and let's get at it.
Igor pulled his automatic, reared back, and kicked the door right below the handle. The frame crunched and burst inward. Yedek lunged through into an empty hall. Nothing there but an old mat and some coat hooks hanging from the wall. He listened hard, but heard only silence. He eased down the hall with Igor right behind him. Dim light from the door barely revealed an empty room beyond the hall. This must have served as an office for the warehouse. At the rear was another door that led to the main storage room. Yedek glanced at Igor and nodded toward the door. Igor eased over and reached for the handle. It turned without a sound. Slowly, slowly, he eased the door open. Voices came from inside, but Yedek couldn't make out what they were saying. Once Igor had the door open, he slipped through and Yedek tiptoed in, shutting the door behind him. The storage room wasn't anywhere near as empty as he'd expected. The two agents crouched behind crates and sacks that had been piled up haphazardly to one side of the door. In the center of the room, a small table held a large stone covered with squiggly marks that pulsed with energy he felt more than saw. That had to be whatever was giving Nosarova fits. 5 people stood in a circle around the stone, including Yana and Karis. Of even greater interest to Yedek was the handful of machine guns leaning on the table between the rebels. He didn't care much for their odds, even with surprise.
I can't return to work now,
Yana said.
The security forces are clearly on to me. Keres too.
Calm down,
said an older man with a gray beard in grease-covered overalls.
We'll find new places for both of you. New identities, you'll be fine.
Igor raised his gun, but Yedek gave a shake of his head. He wanted to see how this played out.
Has anyone heard from Fyodor?
One of the strangers asked. Yedek perked up at that. Maybe he'd finally get that lead he'd been after.
No,
Greybeard said.
They won't make contact until they've reached the boat in Anapa. Too much danger of the government intercepting.
That was all he needed to hear. It made sense. The port of Anapa was one of the busiest in the western half of the empire. If you were trying to sneak out, you couldn't hope for a better place. Maybe the witches would have a way of tracking the girl. Otherwise, he didn't know how they'd find her. Yedek cocked the hammer of his pistol as quietly as he could, steeled himself, popped up, and shot the black stone. It exploded in a shower of gravel. Igor put 2 rounds in one of the strangers before the rest dove for their rifles. Yedek ducked behind the crates just before a fusillade of bullets tore into them. He hoped whatever was in the crates was heavy duty, hopefully steel. There was a loud blast and streams of light poured into the room. The machine guns clattered on full auto, but they weren't hitting the crates. Yedek risked a glance and found the witch descending through a hole in the roof. Bullets ricocheted off an invisible barrier as she descended like an angel of death. She waved a hand, and a gust of wind picked up Yana and Keres and hurled them across the room like so much litter. The man with the beard flung his rifle aside and leapt for one of the crates opposite Yedek. Lightning cracked, and a rebel exploded in a shower of sizzling gore. The last man broke and ran. He might as well not have bothered. Nosarova made a twirling gesture, and what looked like a mini tornado sprang to life around him. He clawed at his throat, and after a moment went still. Yedek was so distracted by all the magic that he almost forgot about the bearded man. Movement drew his eye back in time to see him emerge from the crate with a long-barreled, single-shot pistol. He leveled it at the witch. Yerrick fired an instant before him, blowing his brains all over the sacks behind him. Nasarova landed and looked around at the mess.
Fine shot, agent. Though I assure you I was in no danger from a simple gun.
I had a bad feeling.
Yerrick holstered his pistol.
He was awfully anxious to get his hands on that weapon. So anxious that he abandoned a machine gun to dig it out.
He crossed the room and took the gun from the dead man's hand. Yerrick clicked the trigger to half-cock, lowered the breech, and extracted a large caliber cartridge. It felt cold in his hand. He looked closer at the bullet.
Strange. There's a skull carved into it.
Give me that. Nasarova snatched the cartridge out of his hand.
A death's head bullet. This must be what they used on Ermina. I shall have to apologize to the girl. I thought she was simply careless with her defenses.
What's a death's head bullet?
Igor asked.
It's a bullet infused with dark magic, designed to pierce magical defenses.
Yerrick said. He had read about them years ago, but never thought to see one.
They're better known.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.